We have a fairly busy public hearing agenda this evening, so we'd like to move right along. First item on this evening's agenda is minutes from the previous meeting of September 20th. Any comments or corrections from the board?
I move that they're accepted as written.
Second.
Moved in second. All in favor, please indicate by raising your right hand. Before we go any farther, see, we have one regular member absent, so I'll ask Jan McKay, please, to vote. Next item on this evening's agenda is a list of correspondence. I believe we may have a repeat here from a previous meeting. There is a first item is a letter from myself to the town manager with respect to the letter he received in reference to the Jelen boat ramp application. We just wanted to be sure that there was some correspondence regarding that, because her letter was initially sent to all of the council members. And the letter speaks for itself. If anyone has any interest, they're certainly welcome to read it, but I don't think it bears reading this evening. We have a letter from an attorney, Chris Van Oytis, regarding the Dobie public access waiver. Again, this is a project that's coming before the board, but is not in front of the board at this time. The letter simply states that she will be revising an application and sending it as soon as she has all of her as soon as they have all of their information together. We also have a letter from the code enforcement officer, or a memo to Maureen O'Meara, the town planner, from Ernie McBain regarding some specific issues with respect to the Dobie public access waiver, in particular some issues related to mapping of wetlands. And we have minutes from the September 22nd, 1994 Cape Elizabeth School Building Committee. Again, we thank the committee and the school department for keeping the planning board informed. I think we're probably a fairly well-informed board, as we, most of us have children in the school, so we get to see the many changes week to week. And that completes the correspondence, I believe. Oh, new stuff. On the table this evening is memorandum to Ernie McBain, Ernest McBain, the code enforcement officer, from Maureen O'Meara, the town planner, regarding the status of site plans by the planning board. We have a memorandum to Maureen O'Meara from Ernie McBain regarding In by the Sea. None of the board members had an opportunity to see these, so memorandum to Maureen O'Meara, town planner, from Ernie McBain regarding the Cumberland Farms building permit, and a letter from, to Maureen O'Meara from Michael Hill regarding revisions to the creation of accessory dwelling units, which is under other business in tonight's agenda. I think that covers it all. Birthday cards don't count, so we'll pull those out.
Whose birthday is it?
Nobody's. No. You know, we get these late letters and stuff. Next item on under other business is the town center zone. I see some familiar faces in the audience. What we'd like to do, this is quite a an elaborate zoning rewrite. The planning board has been working on this for the for almost an entire year. Prior to that, there was a town center committee, which also worked on it for, well, the chairman, and for about 9 months to a year. And what we'd like to do is to introduce the audience, is to have Maureen O'Meara. She has two boards set up, and give a brief overview of the pertinent issues related to the town center zone.
I just want to point out that the whole text is about a dozen pages long, and I'm going to try to summarize it in about 5 minutes. So I'm going to be leaving some things out, and I certainly am not deliberately leaving anything out. I'm just trying to make this clear for you. Right now, well, this is the question. Who do I?
Go ahead.
All right.
Yeah, there's no hanging right overhead.
Right now, the area that we are talking about is primarily the Business A zone, and we have a map over here that shows the proposed map change from either Business A or the Residence A zone to what we're calling the Town Center Zone. And I've just done a little couple of comparison charts here. The Town Center Zone is the product of a almost two-year effort by the Town Center Planning Committee, where they looked at the town center. The purpose of the new zone is right away a departure, because the current zone has no purpose statement. It's one of those things left over from many years ago, and we don't even really have a sense of what that zone is supposed to accomplish. The new zone is supposed to create an identifiable town center. It's supposed to allow a mix of retail and residential uses. It's supposed to be pedestrian inviting, and it's supposed to have a visual cohesiveness. And that's just some of the highlights of what it's supposed to do. One of the reasons it's so much different from the existing zoning is not so much that there are a lot of different uses permitted than what are permitted now, but that hopefully by listing the uses a different way, it'll be much more easier for people who are essentially permitted to be able to do the kind of business you've been doing all along. Under the existing zoning, the uses listed here, starting with residential uses, all of these uses are allowed in the zone, but the residential uses are allowed as of right, but there's no new single-family construction allowed. Business, professional offices, retail outfits, and service establishments are allowed with approval from the planning board for site plan review. Under the new zoning, what we're trying to do is establish categories of use where there's a pyramid. If you think of the top as the top of the pyramid and the bottom as the base of the pyramid, if you work your way halfway down this pyramid and you go and you get site plan review from the planning board and you stay within this category of use, you can change from, say, if you're a retail shop, you can change from a clothing store to a shoe store to a video store and not have to go back to the planning board every time. Under the current provisions, we've often had people have to come back to the planning board because the zoning is currently written so tightly and so strictly that even though the impact from a shoe store and a clothing store is there's no difference, they have to go through the expense of going back to the planning board. They're frustrated. Most of the time the board is frustrated, and it doesn't seem to be a very good process for a zone that's supposed to be friendly to commercial uses. So in the proposed zoning, farming uses are listed as approved by right. Residential are single family are approved by right. Multifamily would be explicitly allowed with site plan approval. All of these uses, I'll go right down, residential, professional, business offices, personal services and retail type shops, veterinary and medical clinics, restaurants, all permitted with approval from the planning board with site plan approval, gas stations, institutional uses, congregate care, and what we're calling cottage industry manufacturing. Now you go back to the existing zoning. Once you hit these middle three uses, which I haven't read, not only do you have to get approval from the planning board, you also have to go to the zoning board. And the conclusion that the planning committee reached and the planning board reached is that the review from the zoning board and the planning board is almost identical. And did it make a lot of sense for make people to stop at two different boards for the same type of review? So this is supposed to be get your review from the planning board and you're set as long as you build according to your plan. This one, if you're a restaurant or a parking lot or a gas station, you've got to go to the zoning board first. And then the current zoning does allow mill working as of right. This would fall into cottage industry manufacturing under the proposed zoning, and as long as you have site plan approval, you continue to do it. Let's see, recreational facility and any use that's customary to the use above, these are also provided for here. So there aren't any uses here that are permitted that aren't already permitted here and probably are a little bit more flexible over in the new zoning. Finally, what we've done is we've taken a lot of the dimensional requirements in the existing zoning, and by dimensional requirements, I mean setback requirements. In the existing zoning ordinance, you have to go to another part of the ordinance to even find what your dimensional requirements are. So it's not as user-friendly as it could be, and you kind of have to dig through, and there's a couple lost in through the middle. The current ordinance requires that your setback from the road be 40 feet, that your side and rear yard setbacks be 25 feet, and that you have a limit of 35 feet. What we've done with the new zoning is we've expanded the dimensional requirements, but we've put them all in the same section, so it's easy to find. The other thing we've done is we've broken them up into three different types: school setbacks, municipal building setbacks, and all other uses. And what I've done is just laid out the all other uses, because I think most of the people here are interested in that part. But again, the front setback would go from what is 40 feet in the existing zoning to between 25 and 35 feet. And the idea there is to encourage people to put their buildings closer to the road. That's more pedestrian friendly. It's also going to make businesses much more visible, and hopefully it'll give you a better chance of doing business. Side yard setbacks and rear yard setbacks have been reduced to 15 feet, and a parking setback has been added, and that setback is 15 feet. If, however, you're next to a neighbor who runs a business and the two of you want to share a parking lot, or you want to share a driveway entrance, you can reduce your side yard setback to zero. Building height is 35, just as it is in the existing. And then we've added some other requirements. And the other requirements are intended to get at more of that pedestrian inviting town center look. And we've based a lot of these numbers on an assessment that we've already done of what the existing buildings in the town center are like, what their sizes are, what their footprints are, and all that information is in appendix of the town center plan. So what we're recommending is that whatever the size of your lot, that you not cover it by more than 70%. That any building footprint be no larger than 5,000 square feet. Most of the buildings in the town center are much smaller than that, especially the commercial use type buildings, with one major exception. Building dimensions, new buildings shouldn't have one single dimension that's longer than 100 feet. You can do a lot of jags, but just one blank wall shouldn't be longer than 100 feet. And a minimum lot size for just residential uses. If someone wants to put up an apartment building in the town center, the lot size has to be a minimum of 10,000 square feet. They have to have at least 2,500 square feet per unit in the building, and any building can't have more than four apartments. So that's what's proposed under the new zoning, and while this list is longer than this list, I would suggest that this may be a lot clearer for someone instead of walking in blind and kind of finding this stuff out as they go along. The final thing that's a little different from the existing zoning is we have recommended that because the buildings are going to be moving closer to the street, and because we're trying to encourage a much more pedestrian-inviting area where there are sidewalks and people will be able to walk by buildings, we're recommending that there be design requirements for buildings. And this list doesn't really do justice to the design requirements, because if any of you saw the Cape Courier, you saw that what we've done is we've added in pictures into the zoning ordinance. We decided that we've had the words in there for a long time, and clearly some people have had problems understanding what the town has really wanted to see. So we've added illustrations that look at showing people what a footprint of the building that we think would be appropriate for this town center would look like. None of these things are carved in stone. There's not one standard here that says you cannot do X. What it says is these are the things that we like more than these areas right here. We talk about scale of buildings, that we write like smaller buildings rather than big, massive buildings, height and roof pitch, building and parking orientation. The building should be closer to the street. The parking should be in the side of the building or in the rear of the building. It should not be in the front of the building. Exterior materials should be of quality materials. I skipped one here, openings, doors and windows. We're encouraging people, if they're going to build new construction in the town center, to make sure that they put windows in their walls that face towards the street, and that they have doorways, that they don't build the building so that the back of the building faces Route 77, and as you walk by, all you end up seeing is a back of a building or just a service entrance. And then we've talked about landscaping and site design. And we've had some very specific drawings that illustrate what the goal is about what you should do in that front setback area. Since we're letting you put the building close to the street, but you're not allowed to put parking there, what are you supposed to do with that space? And this is suggesting that maybe there's some landscaping things you should think about. There's some lighting, some trees. You should have a walkway that runs to your building from the street so that people who are walking by can get into the building. Parking lot landscaping, that there ought to be something that buffers your space from the space next to yours, that maybe putting some islands with trees in them will break up a large expanse of asphalt. And finally, buffering for side and rear. And there we've looked at the kind of buffering you should think about when your use is next to a very compatible use. You certainly don't need to completely screen your use. If the building next door is a retail establishment and your retail establishment, you're very compatible. There's no reason to create this solid buffer. But if you're on the edge of the zone and your neighbor is a residential neighbor, you should probably think about a more dense buffer to buffer your less compatible use, your business that with the headlights and the traffic from someone who may live next door. And that's all I have.
Thank you, Maureen. There's quite a bit to digest here, and what I'd like to do is the Planning Board has worked on this for many, many months now, almost a year, as I said before. But what we'd like to do is to open it up to public comment. Anyone who has any specific concerns, compliments, anything specifically that they don't agree with, we welcome comments, and please feel free. We'd ask that you state your name and address and speak into the microphone. At this time, is there anyone from the public that would wish to address the Planning Board? Yes, ma'am.
Do I have to go over there?
Yes, you do. That's so that the people who aren't here can enjoy you at home.
This is Florence Johnson from McKinney Point Road. And what I want to know is how much of a survey have they done about pedestrian use on this town center? Don't most people drive their cars here? Do we need walkways? Most of the pedestrians would be from the schools or behind. They can use the ballpark or through the school area. People coming from the other area are driving. Town hall, yes. Maybe they have to get to the public building, but how much do we need a pedestrian walkway in the town?
I think what I'd like to do is we'll hear all the public comment, and then at the end we'll address those specific items. Would anyone else from the public like to address the Planning Board?
My name's Randy Blake. I live on Ivy Road. The earlier renditions of the town center plan had some language addressing historic preservation. Does this zoning address that issue, and if so, how does it do that?
Any other members of the public? Yes, Mr. Chairman.
My name is Bruce Cogsall. I live at 336 Ocean House Road. I had the great pleasure of serving as chairman of the Town Center Committee and worked many long hours with Tom Emery and Maureen O'Meara and Joe Foley, who is sitting here in the front row with me. I have both some compliments and some concerns, and I'd like to express them both, if I may. First of all, I'd like to compliment the Planning Board on fleshing out the things that we'd left undone, and particularly the design requirements and the drawings that Maureen mentioned. I think that was a great job. On a couple of details in the draft zone, I note that you added a category of business which we did not have, the adult entertainment business, and then I note that you also made it a prohibited business, and I think that's a welcome change. I would suggest over on page 3, in paragraph C6, where the words adult entertainment business appear, I think you need to add the words shall not be permitted. I just kind of, that kind of hangs there. Secondly, in the draft that the Town Center Committee prepared, When we dealt with veterinarian offices, we put a limitation there that he'd be limited to small animal practice only. And I see that that's been deleted from this draft. And I would urge that be put back in. I don't think that there's any current practice involving cows and horses with a veterinarian office in the town. And I don't think that ought to be something that ought to be permitted. We have precluded animal husbandry in our definition of farming, and I don't think there's any thought that cows and horses and such are going to be kept here on any kind of a commercial basis. Finally, on the draft, we had on the gas station language. We had written the numbers that we thought reflected what we currently had. I think it was two islands, and this draft says one island. And I'm not sure how you define an island, but as I drive up to Jonesy's or to Cumberland Farms, I think there are currently two islands, unless you define the whole thing under the canopy as one island. And I think that that probably ought to be corrected if I am correct that is two islands. Finally, on the zone itself, when we were drawing the zone, I think we intended down on the left hand bottom there to draw that line at the dividing line between the RA zone and the BA zone. I think it got moved too far to the left and picks up some RA property. And I would think that to be consistent with what the stated goals of the town center plan are, and consistent with the comprehensive plan, which encourages increased commercial use only within existing business and commercial zones, that line ought to be moved up to the line the correct line between the business zone and the current RA zone.
Thank you very much. Anyone else from the public wish to address the planning board? Yes, sir.
Good evening. I'm Richard Twitchell. I live at 30 Broad Cove Road. And I'm here looking at this from multiple perspectives. As a resident, I am a landscape architect as well. And for those of you that don't know, I'm also the chair of the Regional Transportation Advisory Committee, as appointed by the DOT. Some of the comments that I'm going to make probably go as much to the town center plan as they do to the zone, and they are based largely on the document that was in the courier as opposed to having seen the document, the 12-page document that you have before you. So you'll have to excuse my ignorance in regard to some of the items. I'm interested in having a town center zone that is not only pedestrian-friendly, but user-friendly in general. I think making the area user-friendly will require a combination of good design aesthetics, good planning, safety considerations, and proper material choices. All of these to be done without being overly burdensome on the business owners in the area. As I have not seen the full text, I will comment on some of the drawings that were in the paper and on some of the specific items in those drawings. One of those is on-street parking. While on-street parking is very business friendly, it's nice to pull up to a business and be able to walk in the front door and conduct your business, walk out, jump in your car and go. It is an aesthetic issue. Do we really want on-street parking in the village in Cape Elizabeth? It's also a safety issue. By widening the roadways to accommodate the parking, you increase the length of crosswalks, making them that somewhat unfriendly to the pedestrian. It's also very unfriendly to bicyclists from a safety standpoint. Riding down the road where there is parking and having someone suddenly open their car door into the path of a cyclist is not a fun experience. There are environmental issues because by widening the roadway to accommodate parking, you're also increasing the paved surface in the area. And finally, there is an issue of the esplanade itself, that area of grass or whatever it may be between the curbing and the sidewalk. While I think that esplanades are an aesthetically correct thing to have in the village, I think that a choice needs to be made between either having parking without an esplanade or no parking with an esplanade. Esplanades do create a barrier between parking on street and the sidewalk. And I'm sure many of you have parked somewhere in your life where you've gotten out of your vehicle only to find yourself faced with 4 feet or 5 feet wide of wet grass or snow or whatever else there may be. So you should have one or the other, either parking without an esplanade or no parking with an esplanade. The esplanade itself, when you put trees and lights in it, also is a public works issue. And I'm not sure how much discussion there's been with the public works department in regard to trees and lighting and snow plowing in those areas. In regard to site furnishings, paving, and landscaping, in some ways I think the town should go further than what they may have already gone. I think you should develop standards for furnishings, plant materials, paving patterns, in order that there's a consistent image within the entire zone. The question that I have then is, who's going to choose those elements? The sketches that were in the paper had one image of lighting, benches, and other furnishings. Personally, I found some components of those images to be unattractive, and I'm sure other people would too. So who comes up with those standards? While I believe in the standardization for projecting this image in the community, I also believe that businesses should not be required to foot the bill for those improvements if they're going to be part of the town plan. If the business would normally put in benches, lighting, and things as part of their project, that's one thing. But as an example, if you had a laundry, you may not want to have benches out in the front. If you look at where benches are appropriate or not appropriate, say someone opened a coffee shop, first blush you may think that that's a wonderful place to have a little courtyard, as is on the drawings in the paper, and have some benches where people can go out and sit and enjoy their coffee. But then you think of Green Mountain Coffee in downtown Portland. That is clearly a major hangout. And in that hangout, there are a lot of patrons that dread having to walk through the gauntlet going in and out of Green Mountain Coffee. So again, what kind of image do you want to project? Do you really want courtyards with seating directly in front of some of these businesses? A few notes on the planters that were shown on the plan. Our climate really limits what can be planted in planters. And typically what we see is seasonal flowers, because even a zone 2 hardiness shrub may last a winter or two, but chances are it's not going to last 3 in a tub when the root system starts getting close to the edges of that planter. So with seasonal flowers, those planters are bare several months of the year. They become ashtrays. And I've seen bark mulch on fire in planters before. Planters also typically, as they do on this plan, look like an afterthought to the design, not an integral part of the design. There are very few projects across the country where planters have been used in a manner that makes them look like they were integrated into the actual design of the project and not as an afterthought. I've given you a lot of different, just throwing out ideas. I'd like to say what my feelings are on some of these things specifically. I think that we should not encourage on-street parking. I think that we should have continuous promenade. I think that we should have bicycle lanes on both sides of the street. I believe that crosswalks, sidewalks, and entry plazas should be the same materials and patterns throughout the zone. I think the site furnishings and landscaping should be standardized throughout the zone. I think the seating areas and entry plazas should be appropriately located. And while I commend the board for trying to make the zone a little more friendly to business, I believe that a committee, maybe a design review committee, or a liaison post of some sort within the town, should be developed to work with property owners as opposed to against property owners, to develop those projects in a manner that will meet the goals of the Town Center plan and the Town Center goal. I feel that Cape Elizabeth has a great opportunity to project an image that the residents of this town will be very proud of. And I think that the establishment of the Town Center Zone in conjunction with the master plan will accomplish that end. I also feel that Cape Elizabeth needs to shed its anti-business image, and developing this zone without thought of business needs and resources is short-term thinking. We could use more business in this community. There is a burden on the taxpayer in this community. More business in this community would offset that. And I don't think we should be developing a town center zone with restrictions in place that could continue to feed the anti-business attitudes. I would ask the planning board to look at the provisions of the zone. There's a lot of work that you have done. I think that there is still work that you could do. And I'd like you to make sure that you do take the time to do this right the first time through and make the zone friendly to all and an asset to the Cape Elizabeth community. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Twitchell. Anybody else from the public wish to speak regarding the Town Center Zone? Mr. Foley?
My name is Joe Foley. I'm at Spoondrift Lane. I have been a member of the Town Center Planning Committee, and prior to that, the subcommittee of the Main Street 90 group that started this process, I think. And I think it's important for the committee to know and the people that are here tonight to know that this has been an evolving process that has been the result of the work of an awful lot of dedicated people. It isn't a one-shot deal that was just intimated. It has been given a tremendous amount of thought, a tremendous amount of input. It was not done in a vacuum. It was done in a very objective manner with the input of a lot of people that were chosen by the town council for a variety of reasons to make sure that the input of the business people, that the residents, that all of the citizens of Cape Elizabeth had an opportunity to tell what they wanted in their town center. In the Town Center Subcommittee of the Main Street 90 program, Henry Adamson's committee started out by consulting with all of the pertinent towns managers, fire chiefs, police chiefs, state arborists, the town forester, the school committee, and others, and developed a program that resulted in some cosmetic changes to the town. More importantly, what evolved from that was that there was a tremendous amount of interest in among the citizens of Cape Elizabeth to make sure that the character of Cape Elizabeth was maintained in their town center and the things that the town's taxpayers wanted were addressed. And as a result, the town council chose the town center planning committee that worked, as Maureen said, as Tom said, over 2 years. Again, it wasn't done in a vacuum. It was done as a result of consulting with people such as the Northeast Regional Planners Association. It was done with a tremendous amount of input from arborists, landscapers, and others. It wasn't as intimated previously. And nobody that I know of feels that there is an anti-business climate in Cape Elizabeth. I won't address the generalizations that were made, but I think it is important to know that there were a number of town hearings held where the input of the citizens of Cape Elizabeth were addressed, and this is the result. There is a very extensive document that came out of all of those hearings and all of those meetings. The result of a year and a half of meetings where the townspeople were asked what they wanted and what they didn't want. This is what the townspeople told us they wanted. I think it is an extremely important change that makes sure that we do address the things that the townspeople do not want, and it certainly should not be written off as being a spur-of-the-moment judgment. This is a document that I would hope you would adopt because it is what the citizens of Cape Elizabeth want. As far as the safety and other individual issues that Florence and some others have addressed, there are areas where there is areas where people might have differences of opinion. In Florence's concern, as far as pedestrians are concerned, one of the things that we suggested the on-street parking was to slow down the speeding traffic that was going through town. There are a number of ways that that might have been done. This was just one. But these were all given considerable thought, and they are there for very specific but objective reasons. There were no subjective or selfish reasons, because we did have a very broad and wide-ranging group of people on that committee, so that everybody was given a very ample opportunity to be heard, even specialists such as landscapers and arborists. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other comments from the public? Going once, going twice? Seeing none, I'll close the public hearing. What I'd like to do is I will go down the list, and having also served on the committee, as was noted, what I'd like to do is briefly address the issues that were raised, the specific references to the ordinance I'll ask Maureen to address. First of all, with respect to why pedestrians in the town center, I think if there's any reason, there's any number of reasons, but through the comprehensive plan, there was a concern there was no center to the town of Cape Elizabeth. And one of the ways of designating or creating a town center is to have a place in which is inviting for people to walk. Admittedly, Cape Elizabeth is a bedroom community, and as many people are going to drive through Route 77 to get to the beaches and go through the town center to get there with no interest in stopping and walking. We felt, however, that that shouldn't preclude the ability or the creation of a pedestrian-friendly environment, one that's pretty typical of even a middle-sized community that I grew up in Bangor, where the trees were all lined in elm trees, streets were all lined with elm trees. Very inviting to walk. There was an esplanade, there was curbs along the street, there was on-street parking. Very inviting environment. Regardless of what happened in terms of the aesthetics of the building, the environment with which the pedestrians could walk was extremely inviting. The other reason, as an example, is that we have people working in the town center. For most of us that work in Portland or outside Cape Elizabeth, it's easy to forget that people actually do work in the town center, and it would be nice to think that one could walk to the shopping center without having to get in a car at town hall, drive over there, and then sit and eat a pizza or get a cup of coffee. And aside from the functional aspects are the aesthetic attributes of having sidewalks, esplanades, and trees. Again, I think we felt as a committee, and I think the ordinance language supports the notion that this is a way in which to slow down traffic. When people come down 77 at 45 miles an hour, there's going to be something that happens in the town center that signals them to slow down. Lastly, I find it every day that I drive into work and I see retired people and joggers and so forth walking in Route 77. of all the beautiful landscapes we have in town, the beaches, the woods, and so forth, I find it absolutely amazing that people are left to walk in the road to get their daily exercise. Certainly, they could drive to the beach or do something else. We're all aging. My hairline proves that, and that we look to the future when there'll be a lot of hopefully retired people in Cape Elizabeth and can enjoy a walk from the adjacent residential areas or perhaps a bike ride into the town center and walking around. Build it and they will come, so to speak, and I think that's what the committee was looking to. I don't want to belabor that point, but that's very important and central to the whole idea of the design guidelines to the town center. Mr. Blake had a question regarding historic language in the ordinance. I think what I'd like to do before we address that specifically is to simply state that the way in which this process can work is in any number of ways in developing this language. In some communities, it's not unusual to hire a team of architects and engineers to do a $30,000 to $60,000 study and have almost a comprehensive planning type process involved, and from that develop the very specific design guidelines. In general, we felt, given the attributes with which we had to work, we had a volunteer committee, we had some minor input from paid professionals to help with the graphic, but this language is reasonably user-friendly, it's politically acceptable, we think. It's a fine line between providing guidelines and then handcuffing people with having everything that's so specific. You know, there's only one roof pitch, there's only one color, there's only one finished material, and we wanted to avoid that. And that's why there isn't a long, detailed section here on history. I guess what I'll do is I'll go down some of Mr. Twitchell's comments and then go back and ask that Maureen discuss the issue of historic and some of the other references under Mr. Cogshell's discussion. With respect to on-street parking, I think Mr. Foley stated quite clearly what the board's thinking was. And again, we haven't resolved the issue of on-street parking and bicycles. Perhaps bicycles have to sidetrack the town center at times, or maybe they're accommodated in a bike lane. But in any event, that's a denser activity, and bicycles will need to slow down just as automobiles will. But the purpose of the on-street parking was one so that one could walk along the sidewalk and not be faced with trailer trucks and other cars and so forth driving along at 35 and 40 miles an hour. If there's anything that will get people a sense of not wanting to be along a street, that's it. And I think if one were to ask anyone who's walking along Route 77, one of the worst parts of having that experience is having trucks and cars pass at 50 miles an hour or 45 miles an hour. That just adds to the buffer. The assumption is that we're going to widen the street to accommodate on-street parking. I believe the committee discussed the notion, and yes, we have to resolve all of this with MDOT, and it's going to be an uphill battle all the way. But there would be some combination where the street wouldn't necessarily get widened, that the lanes might be striped differently, that there would be some additional widening for the parking. The committee has taken under consideration, and the board, and we've shown in our graphics this issue of safe crosswalks. Where we do have crosswalks, we would have a curb widening or a neck out so that the road narrows there, and that the parking, on-street parking, then is clearly defined in front of the shops. Bicyclists are always a dilemma. That's a dilemma throughout the city of Portland, for example, along Deering Avenue, where we have, whether it's Deering Oaks Park, there's on-street parking, yet there's a bike lane there. That's something that is going to have to be wrestled with. It's a similar case down in South Portland, so that's nothing unique to the town center. And I think if I had to give over the town center to either bicyclists or pedestrians, I prefer to give it to pedestrians, or I think that's what the committee was thinking. Parking, with respect to the Esplanade, the issue here is that there's an aesthetics that's developed. When I grew up in Maine, there was an Esplanade that had elm trees in it. Today what's happened is that we've gone from granite curbing to bituminous curbing, and the only way to support bituminous curbing is to back it up with a sidewalk. Otherwise, it gets smashed by the snowplows. So there's been a very gradual transition from what used to be a rural or more village-like quality of having an esplanade with elm trees. We've lost that, and now we have nothing but curb and then sidewalk. And that's not a very nice place for people to walk. So I think the committee in its design guidelines and the planning board in its design guidelines is trying to incorporate both situations where we can have street trees, we can have an esplanade, and we can have on-street parking. Aesthetic standards, the minute one gets into aesthetic standards, one has really opened up Pandora's box. Architects will present for the 900 standards, they'll present the 901 standard that is contrary to all the other 900s and will be a brilliant solution. We've preferred to provide guidelines so that one making an application before the board has a reasonable understanding of examples that we feel are consistent with the qualities that are represented in the town center study. But we're not going to instruct landscape architects and architects how to design in the private sector. With respect to the public sector, the ideal situation here would be that the town would come in and plant trees and do all of the public improvements on both sides of the road, and boom, it'd all be there, and it would be there to inspire private investment. That's done in many communities. My understanding is that's not the situation that's going to occur in Cape Elizabeth. This will be phased in over time. So we had to have the design guidelines general enough so that if shop owners wanted to fix up a place in front of the stores, those would be available. The anti-business image, a part of the anti-business image, I think, rests in this hall with concern about the attitude that the planning board or the way in which applicants are treated before the planning board. We have reviewed our record with respect to business applications and all other applications. We're not saying that we have the quickest or the easiest process in the state. We feel it's reasonably fair. We feel that the planning board treats applicants with respect, but the approval record is a very high percentage of all applicants that come before the board. And with the issue of do it right the first time, I think that has to be put into a context of what did we have to work with. And again, as Bruce and Joe have said, we worked with volunteer committees, we worked as a volunteer planning board, and aside from some very minor funds for some assistance with graphics, this has all been done through volunteer time. And I think the product is quite extraordinary given that. With that, what I'd like to do is ask Maureen just to touch briefly on the issue of whether or not this historic language.
Your memory serves you well, and there is still a provision in here, and it's an addition to the building permit section of the zoning ordinance. And I'll just read you the language because it's very short. There's a one sentence that's been added to it, and it requires that no permit for demolition of a locally historic structure designated in the town center plan shall be issued until 30 days after notice has been provided to the town manager, to the code enforcement officer, to the historical advisory committee, and published in a newspaper of general circulation. So there's nothing here that prohibits demolition of a structure which the town may consider historic. What it does do is put in a 30-day delay period.
And it doesn't address moving disturbed.
This would only apply to demolition.
I would also like to remind the audience that the board's deliberation is simply a recommendation of some sort to the town council, that concerns that are raised at this meeting will be on the record and can be passed on to the town council. And there should be, I believe, another opportunity with the town council for another public hearing. Mr. Cogshell raised the issue of specific reference under the adult entertainment that it is not a permitted use, is prohibited. I think the board can discuss that later. With respect to the veterinarian limiting of animal size, I don't have a clear recollection as to where we ended on that.
Originally, there was a requirement, a recommendation from the Town Center Committee. I believe what the Planning Board discussed was because the comprehensive plan recommends the preservation of agricultural uses, it seemed to make sense that if a veterinarian wanted to have an office in the Town Center and was to serve large animals on existing farms, that that would be appropriate. I believe there was an expectation that there wouldn't have been any large animals in the town center. It was basically just the office. I think there was a question about the gas stations, and I remember this one. The board reviewed the recommendation from the town center committee, and they decided that they would make some changes to it. So that's why it was dropped from two islands to one. And as for the zone line itself, I have been informed that I think the line we have in question is the Farm and Fish Market extension. And I'm still researching that. There's a question, I think the intent was all along that the zone line wrap around the Farm and Fish Market property. There's a question about whether the line actually extends beyond the Farm and Fish Market lot south. And I need to do some more research on that. The what's proposed so far is supposed to be just a holding steady of the existing business zone line in that area. I've been told now that, in fact, maybe our zoning map may not be quite accurate, but that needs to be reviewed.
Okay, that's something that could be discussed and forwarded to the council, and in the meantime, you could continue to look into that. I believe that's most of the comments. I do thank the public. Is there any other comment the public would like to make in reference to comments that we've made regarding your comments? Yes, ma'am.
I just have one more question. How is this going to be paid for?
The question is, how is this going to be paid for? Let me state very clearly that this ordinance there's not dollar one tied to this ordinance. This is not an implementation or a construction plan. It's simply zoning language that sets forth land use and development standards for the town center. There's no proposal here for developing any of the sidewalks, tree plantings. The town has applied for some funds as a response to the planning board concerned with the school project for studying of Scott Dyer Road, but this, as I understand, does not include this part of the town center.
It may include.
It may, okay. But again, this is not a development proposal. It's simply zoning language. Not simply, it is zoning language. With that, what I'd like to do, since we're quite a bit behind on our schedule this evening, is turn to the board and just go through. The board has discussed this at workshop and at our last meeting, regular meeting, at length. And if the board would be so willing as to simply respond to any of the issues that the public has raised or specific items that were changed most recently, and perhaps we can move this forward this evening. Any comments from the board? Mr. Edsel?
I think the only thing I'd want to respond to is a good point by Mr. Cogashaw. While he was talking, I looked up in the comprehensive plan. It says quite specifically to expand develop the town center zone within the existing business zone. Mm-hmm. I would not want to see what we have proposed change, because I think our thought or mindset at the time was that this is the area of future planning for the town center zone. It does not affect the properties or those owners of those properties right now. It really applies just to two. I think it's the Reiche or Reich lot, and the two Jordan lots are in that location. I might suggest that we just and I hope we recommend this to the town council, when we recommend it to them, simply acknowledge that fact with some explanation of our intent for future planning, and let the town council decide that issue.
Okay, thank you. Any other comments from the board? Again, Ms. McKay, you'll be voting on this item. With that, do I hear a motion? Did I have a motion? Mr. Edsel?
I have a motion for the board to consider. Be it ordered that, based on the proposed text changes and the facts presented, the proposed town center zoning ordinance amendments and zoning map change be recommended to the town council for adoption.
I have a motion. I have a second.
Second.
Second it?
Second. Could I have a clarification about what the proposed language changes are? I'd like to suggest that we do adopt Mr. Coggeshall's suggestion about shall not be permitted on C6 on page 3.
Isn't that clearly under prohibited uses, activities?
I think it just spells it out a little better.
Excuse me?
I think it just spells it out a little better.
For people who use this ordinance, it's wonderfully blunt. There's no mistake.
Yeah, if I'd be willing to amend motion for that text change. It is slightly redundant, but it's an issue where it's implied in all the other statements or
well, one,
especially
one,
stated.
One through five are sentences, and
right.
Six is just a phrase.
First and second. Any other discussion on the motion and second? I believe that there should be an item which addresses the issue of the zoning map change.
Mm-hmm.
That be made part of the ordinance that the zoning map change be consistent with the existing business zone.
In the area south of Town Hall?
Yes, and between the RA and BA zone.
That is the boundary of the Farm and Fish Market property.
Any other comment? Motion second. All those in favor, please indicate by raising your right hand. Passes unanimously. Thank you very much for coming this evening. Your comments are very much appreciated. Mr. Twitchell, not to cut you off, if you would care to get a copy of the ordinance and take your, I think, quite studied concerns and draft them for the town council, I think you could become more involved in the process. Okay, thank you. Next item on this evening's agenda is the accessory dwelling unit. A request by the town council to consider amendments allowing accessory dwelling units within single-family homes. I'll ask Maureen to give a brief discussion on this, but I want to have it clear that this is ordinance revision language. It's come from the council to the board. And the board has made some suggestions, and we're still very interested in comment, and I think there's going to be some interesting discussion on this evening. Maureen, would you please give a brief overview?
Again, what I've done is I just tried to compare what existing language is compared to what's proposed for the board's consideration this evening. Currently in the ordinance under section 1947D, there's a section called conversion to multi-unit dwellings. And what is being proposed tonight is that this whole section be replaced with a new section called creation of an accessory dwelling unit. And basically, the differences are under the existing section, there's no purpose statement at all, but it's implied that the purpose is to allow people to convert. Under the new provision, the purpose is explicitly stated that it is to provide affordable housing while maintaining a single-family character. Under the existing, there is no minimum lot size. So as long as you can meet the other requirements, it doesn't matter what the size of your lot is upon which the house sits. Under the proposed zoning, the lot size has to be at least 15,000 square feet. Under the dwelling size of your house that's going to be converted, the existing requires that the house has to be at least 2,500 square feet in size. The new proposal reduces that down to 1,500 square feet. Under the existing, the new unit that's created has to be at least 900 square feet in size. So what that's doing is it's almost requiring that a building be divided in half. And there's no limit on how much of a building can be divided in half. So you have to go with at least 900. You could actually take your 2,500 square foot house and divide it exactly in half under the existing zoning. Under the proposed zoning, the accessory unit you're creating can be no smaller than 300 square feet, no larger than 600 square feet. And in addition, it can be no larger than 25% of the existing dwelling unit. So what this is doing is it allows you to start with a smaller house, but it restricts how much of the house you can convert. With a 1,500 square foot house, you're not going to be able to put in a 600 square foot unit. You're really going to be forced to go a lot smaller than that. The floor area increase under the proposed, you can actually add on to the house once you meet the 1,500 square foot limit. And you want to, let's say, because of the size or the shape of your house, you actually want to put on an addition. You can add an addition that's up to 15% of the existing square footage of the house. Under the existing, that's the same thing. It's a 15% increase. Under the existing provisions, you're required to have two parking spaces for the multi-unit in addition to your existing single-family home. Under this proposal, you're only required to have one parking space. In addition, both standards have requirements that the units, even in the conversion process, are supposed to be architecturally compatible with a single-family neighborhood. Under the new proposal, however, keeping with progress, we use a lot more words, so we can argue that maybe it's a little bit more specific and perhaps a little bit more strict. In addition, under the new proposal, that if you add a unit, you can't also put in a home occupation. There was concern that you might be overloading a structure or overloading a lot. So you basically got to make a decision on what you want. And also, under the new proposal, if you choose to go with adding a unit, the structure has to be owner-occupied. It doesn't require that the owner live in the house and that someone else live in the unit, but somewhere the owner has to be living in this structure. And that's it.
Thank you, Maureen. What I'd like to do at this time, again, let me just put things in perspective. A 300-square-foot space is equivalent to, a living room, a family room that's about 22 feet wide and, 22 feet long and about 14 feet wide. That's pretty typical of a breezeway between a garage and a house in many cave houses. What I'd like to do at this time is open the meeting for public comment, and at the close of the public comment, open up for additional board discussion. Again, as with the last item, if you'd please step to the podium and introduce yourself, giving your name and address, and speak into the microphone. At this point, is there anyone interested in addressing the board with respect to accessory dwelling units?
Michael Biodler, 29 Trundy Road. I think the lot size, the new lot size is too restrictive. I'm suggesting it should be around 12,000 square feet. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other members of the public wish to address the planning board? Yes, in the back.
My name's Greg Powell. I live at 9 Bowery Beach Road. My comments I wanted to preface by thanking the planning board for really exercising its discretion and allowing the public an opportunity to state its views with respect to this proposed change. I understand you did have discretion in that regard, and I think it's very much appreciated. I think it's especially important because the change in the ordinance that's under consideration is a change which represents a change in the contract, if you will, with Cape Elizabeth homeowners, especially in single-family zones. The change in the contract being proposed is that to allow the split up of single-family homes under more readily meetable circumstances. While there are some similarities between the existing ordinance and the proposed change, the obvious intent and purpose of the proposed change is to make the split up of single-family homes more possible and thereby achieve the objectives of accomplishing so-called affordable housing and perhaps even another objective of opening up living space for elderly relatives and the like. That has been suggested. I oppose the proposed change as it is currently drafted, or at least the last draft I have seen it. And I oppose the change, and I urge the Planning Board to resoundingly and clearly tell the Town Council that it's a bad idea for the following reasons. First, I think the change would have a net harmful effect on the town. Secondly, in broad terms, I think the change meets no demonstrated and documented need for a significant aspect of the Cape's current situation. The third reason I oppose the proposed change is that I think that the change, to the extent it has good and important objectives, has no workable and enforceable mechanism to allow the ordinance to be monitored and enforced by the town. So I think there are serious enforceability problems with the ordinance change as it's proposed. In addressing each of those points in specific terms, the most fundamental criticism I have of the proposed change is that its inevitable effect will be to lower property values, especially in single-family RA zones. It will do this for reasons which harken back to litigation the town was engaged in for nearly 3 years in the late 1980s and early 1990s. That litigation was litigation in which some 24 of my neighbors and I participated, and the net result of that was a holding by the Maine Supreme Court that a fundamental purpose of zoning is to uphold property values, and that the town's criteria requiring any conversion to meet a test of no adverse impact on surrounding property values was a legitimate constitutional and social objective. The town spent a fair amount of time and resources upholding its ordinance, and now this proposed change is being entertained, which will have the exact opposite effect on Cape taxpayers. I don't think we should be moving in that direction, and I want to explain a little bit more about why I think we shouldn't be moving in that direction. The ordinance, as it's proposed, purports to retain the adverse impact standard. In other words, an applicant who is going to shift or wants to split up their single-family home supposedly has to meet the standard of no adverse impact, or so I am told about the last draft. However, the evidence in the case that went before the Maine Supreme Court and which this town supported at that time was clear that when you disrupt and change and allow a change in use, especially in single-family neighborhoods, which is one of the, I think, very attractive aspects of the Cape for many, many people, you inevitably cause a depreciation in surrounding property values. Now, the town and many people may have certain objectives that they want to accomplish through ordinance changes. But for most Cape citizens, the single most important asset that they own are their homes. And what we are proposing and talking about here today is making it easier to devalue and depreciate the value of those homes through accommodating the split up of single family homes under the various criteria set forth on the proposed amendment. So I think it's a bad idea because I think it's going to have that harmful effect. And for proof of that, I stand behind the town's own position some 2 years ago before the Maine Supreme Court, upheld by the Supreme Court, advocated and endorsed by the town, and now we're facing a shift in position. And I see many of my neighbors upset about that, and I am one of those upset citizens of the Cape. The other harm that this ordinance will create is that it will necessarily, and by its own objective, try to increase the density of population and use in the Cape. And while there may be certain aspects of the comprehensive plan in the town that do encourage affordable housing and other objectives. Another objective of the comprehensive plan is to maintain the lack of density, the open space, the kind of single-family neighborhoods that the Cape is desired for and is important. And I think when you reduce the size of the home that can be used, you reduce the number of parking spaces that are required, and the other changes that are proposed in here, what you are inevitably saying is that there's going to be more people per square foot, more noise, more cars, more density, and less attractive neighborhoods. My second point, I think, was to say that I didn't think that there was a demonstrable need for this change. And I base that on the following. There has been discussion in the newspapers and other places where we in the public get our information to the effect that the code enforcement officer has received requests asking about whether homes can be converted. And I would submit that, you know, of course, that does demonstrate some interest in the idea of transforming property. But I don't, beyond that, I am not sure what study or survey or even poll has been taken of Cape Elizabeth citizens to see whether they really think the ordinance needs to be changed. And from what I can tell, there is no evidence of a need for a change. The only evidence I'm aware of is, I believe, some evidence that may have been cited by a member of Parkhurst at the last meeting to the effect that most Cape citizens weren't in favor of this kind of thing. Now, maybe there is some objective, a hidden objective that we don't know about, and maybe there's some study out there that shows that this ordinance is going to accomplish the objectives of affordable housing. But I think until we have some serious groundwork done and accomplished, I don't know why we're going to change the ordinance. It's the old adage, if it's not broken, don't fix it. And certainly, if we don't have evidence of a serious problem, why should we go and tinker with the existing ordinance as it's written? The final point that I wanted to make was that I do not believe that the ordinance is workable or enforceable as it's written. There has been much discussion about whether the ordinance should have the objective of really being an affordable housing vehicle or whether it should simply be a vehicle to accommodate independent living space for elderly relatives. The latter objective, I think, is a good one, and I think most of my neighbors share that view. In fact, in the litigation before, what we experienced was a situation where the initial application and proposal was to convert an existing single-family home so that an elderly relative could live there. And all of my neighbors, without exception, signed on to this and agreed and thought it was a wonderful idea. And then the question was posed at the zoning board as to whether this was really truly the intent and whether the applicant would agree to a condition which would limit the use to the elderly relative. And there was a lot of backpedaling and eventually a statement to the effect that that condition would not be acceptable. Now, under those circumstances, one has to ask, what is it that you really feel this ordinance is going to accomplish? Is it going to provide independent living space for relatives? Or is it going to be an affordable housing vehicle? An affordable housing vehicle, I submit, is not going to be accomplished by creating a 600-square-foot apartments and, in the meantime, devaluing single-family residences in single-family zones. That's not the way we're going to achieve that objective. And I think to try to accomplish it in a piecemeal type of fashion is not really a very effective way to proceed. But focusing on the aspect of this ordinance that I think has some merit, that is providing independent living space for elderly relatives, the problem there is that the ordinance itself has no restrictions, as I have seen it, the proposed ordinance, which would limit it to that. And I'm not sure, A, you can do it, number one, legally, and B, even if you could do it, we have to ask ourselves, what is the long-term effect of such a change and how would it be enforced? And I submit to you that it cannot be enforced effectively given the current resources available to the town. And I offer the following reasons. First, what would happen would be that, like in Nantucket, apparently, I don't know anybody else who has this kind of an ordinance, and apparently the only place I've heard of is Nantucket. And so down in Nantucket, the owners have to submit an affidavit every 2 years saying that an elderly relative lives there. And I'm not sure we're ready to take on that kind of intrusive approach to make sure that people follow the ordinance as it's written. And but even if we get beyond the affidavit issue, then the issue becomes, if you convert a single-family dwelling and you split it up into an apartment in a neighborhood and devalue the values of their neighboring properties. Then what happens when the elderly relative leaves and the objective of the ordinance is no longer being served? You still have the structure, you still have the change, you still have that second kitchen that Ernie's always concerned about. What's going to happen then? The kitchen is there, the neighboring properties have been devalued, the neighbors have suffered a property loss because of that, and there's no one really, unless you're going to have people knocking on doors, who's buying this house and what are you going to use it for? I mean, it really does not make sense. So what I'm suggesting is that as applied to single-family residences, this ordinance does not have a workable enforcement mechanism for any legitimate objective of the ordinance. And by legitimate, I say to be, you know, to provide independent living space for elderly relatives. And the final point with respect to enforceability would be that let's assume that we're willing to take on this task of actually going and knocking on doors, getting affidavits, and considering the needs of, and considering applications for split up of single family homes. I'd submit that if the code enforcement officer now feels that it is a need and it's a burden or what have you to answer these inquiries and not have some answer for them, it's going to be 10 times worse then. Because then you're going to have the code enforcement officer responding to all of these claims or requests. You're going to have the zoning board responding to all of them. And then you're going to have to enforce all of the conversions in the first place. Now, maybe there won't be that many. And if there aren't that many, then I'd submit there is no need for this. But if there are a lot, and then it's going to have a major impact on single-family homes, and we shouldn't do it because, in the first instance, the most fundamental objective of zoning, according to our own Supreme Court here in Maine and the United States Supreme Court through Justice Douglas, who certainly was no conservative, was to preserve the single-family character, neighborhood, and the values of single-family homes. If you keep your priorities straight, you will not send this proposed ordinance change to our council with a positive vote. You will tell them that it's a bad idea and they ought to drop it in its tracks.
Thank you very much. Any other members of the public wish to address? Yes, ma'am.
My name is Cheryl Hagman. I live at 11 Bowery Beach Road. It's pretty hard to follow Mr. Powell, but I do agree with everything that he has said, and I am opposed to this proposal. A couple of things that I'll just mention. The first one I saw in the proposal, 15,000 square feet of land was needed. I thought to myself, well, that sounds like a pretty big lot size. And I looked up in my dictionary, and it's only a third of an acre, if I'm not mistaken. And to me, that doesn't sound like very much land to then split up this single-family home. So that looks to me like higher density. I don't want to see my single-family neighborhood or any single-family neighborhood here lose the rural character. I mean, when I bought my house, it was zoned as single-family houses. The adverse impact on property. I certainly don't want to see my property values go down. Basically, Mr. Powell covered most of my other notes. But I just wanted to let you know that I am against this, and thank you very much.
Thank you. Other members of the public? Yes, sir, in the front.
My name is Glenn Robinson. I live at 24 Robin Hood Road. 4 or 5 years ago, my neighborhood went through this issue with a conversion before the zoning board. And at that time, the issue was under the current ordinance as it is. And my neighborhood has quite a few houses in it. And we were strongly opposed to the conversion at the time, which I understand it's much more detailed and has higher requirements than what's being proposed now. Part of the concern was the adverse impact on property values. It was also a concern that this was a single-family area that was being developed for the first time into a duplex, a house that had been built as a single-family and was being converted. We attended two different hearings in front of the zoning board, and ultimately the zoning board decided that the conversion requirements were not met. and they couldn't be met because of the way the building was built and because of the certain requirements that are in the ordinance now. There was a substantial public showing at that time, probably 40 residents that showed up and were very vociferous in their opposition to that conversion. I see this as a lessening of the standards and requirements, and I'm definitely opposed to it. I think that this change in the ordinance is a big mistake. I'm not sure the conversion requirements were sufficiently strict as they were, and this seems to me almost a wholesale repudiation of that into a rather liberal, if not permissive, use, to the point of where realistically there are very few controls on subdividing at this point. Let me just follow up with something Mr. Powell said. I think that once you impose or once you permit this type of use, if the owner goes to sell the property, I do not think legally you can enforce any requirement. I think it's unconstitutional to try to tie the hands of the later owner to any requirements whatsoever, which means that the objective of providing perhaps housing for an elderly relative will be immediately lost upon sale of the property. That's not enforceable. And I think that's something that probably the town attorney ought to address. But my understanding of the law is you cannot make those kinds of conditions stick. In terms of the affordable housing issue, I don't disagree that that's something the town probably ought to look at. I don't think this is the way to do it. I think this is a backdoor approach to it. I think if you're going to address the issue of affordable housing, then do it head on. Do a study, decide what you want, decide what's required, and deal with that, and deal with it in an upfront manner as affordable housing. This will not meet that objective. And if it does, I don't think it's the way to meet it. So I guess my feeling is, overall, I think this is a bad idea. I agree with what Mr. Powell said, and I just wanted to add those additional concerns that I have. Thank you.
Thank you. Yes.
My name is Roger Rio. I live in on Bridle Path Way, in the same neighborhood as Mr. Robinson. Just a minor point of correction, one of his comments was it wasn't a conversion request. The house was still being built and had been designed as having two stories, and each having a kitchen and full living area with separate entrances. And I think if it weren't for the neighbors reviewing the building as it was going up and seeing what was being constructed and what was rough plumbed and electricity that was going in, that building would have been completed, perhaps. I don't have all the facts, but that was what our view of it. And there was a great deal of emotion, I want to tell you, in the neighborhood about that structure going up, some of being just the aesthetics of the design, which was pretty bad considering the rest of the neighborhood. But that's nothing that we could comment about. We could comment about the intent and use of the structure that did affect the values of the property right next door. And the gentleman who lived there at the time, who hired a lawyer, lost some value in his estimation with regard to the way that the structure is designed. We don't know today how that structure is being used. It was plumbed and wired for a second kitchen. Anyone can do that without letting anyone in their building and can change the structure. And the only way to enforce it, to enforce Mr. Powell's comments, the only way to enforce it is for neighbors to go against neighbors and watch what it is that they're doing. This loosens it up too much, and I don't believe it adds value. And while I have the opportunity, there's a similar ordinance. It was mentioned about work in the home, and we had that situation in our neighborhood as well, as someone modified their home for a business. There were three or four people coming there every day, and the only way that that was corrected was, again, neighbors policing their neighbors. That is not the way to enforce these kinds of ordinances. That structure that I'm talking about was modified, and trucks were delivering, making business deliveries during the day, and that was a concern certainly about children and a neighborhood that has very little automobile traffic. Certainly, the only truck that come through was perhaps a Jeep that delivers the mail, but this was having UPS trucks and those sorts of things. So that also for you to think about that and these kinds of things. How can you say someone cannot work in that addition, can't run a business? The only way that can be monitored is neighbors watching, see what goes on in that in that home. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Yes, in the back.
I'm Ruth Watson, and please excuse me, I have laryngitis, but I felt it was important to come here and try to speak with you anyway. Glenn Robinson and Roger Rio and myself all live in that neighborhood of Sherwood Forest. My property abuts the property that was the subject of much discussion. I was not here for the most recent hearing when a denial took place to allow the conversion to a multi-family unit. However, I did send a letter that I believe parts of it were read here. I agree with everything that Mr. Powell and everyone has said here. I feel that I probably better than anybody in this room can quantify what's happened in terms of property values. Even though the conversion technically was not approved by the zoning board. Talking about policing of the property, I'm not going to get into specifics. However, I believe that enforceability is a real issue because I think it is a problem currently today. I think zoning codes and rules are violated that are not enforced. I'm not going to be specific, but I feel most certainly that that is happening in the town of Cape Elizabeth. Part of the change in the code requires that parking be provided for this additional space. Not only was the structure at the corner of Little John and Shore Road built in such a way that I believe did not blend with the aesthetics of the surrounding properties, but now what has transgressed here is that this property had gone for a building permit a year and a half ago to expand the parking places for this house at the corner of Little John and Shore Road. When I bought my house, which abuts that property, I am in the back of it. It was a one garage, supposedly single family dwelling. The board, the building zoning committee allowed them to build a three car garage, to convert the one-car garage into a room in that house. I talked with Ernie McVane about that. I wanted to know what my legal ramifications were to stop the building of the garage because it took away views from my house. Not only was I looking at a multifamily dwelling, I then had to look at the fact that a three-car garage was built, obstructing my views, and to add insult to injury because of the policing that took place in the neighborhood. Trees were very strategically placed in front of the remaining views of my window to the side of the garage. And you talk about repudiation and things like that for policing your own neighborhood. I think there are enforceability problems with the new code as it's being written. Number one, I don't think the current zoning is being enforced today. Second of all, I don't think that owner-occupied or not, you're going to be able to enforce that. How are you going to know whether it's owner usage or not, or family relatives or not? And second of all, home occupation. I believe strongly that there probably within our neighborhood of Sherwood Forest is a home occupation going on as well as multifamily usage. I'm a person who likes to quantify things. I believe if I'm going to use a basis, the tax basis that the town has assessed me on the value of my property at 6 Little John Road. That property value is about $25,000 less than what I paid for that house in 1989. My house was on the market for 3.5 years. I had 2 offers on my house, which I believe have something to do with the property that abuts my house. And most recently, the offer that I had on my house was an additional $15,000 below the tax assessed value of Cape Elizabeth. I firmly believe that my property values have been devalued by the presumed assumption of usage to the abutting property, to the building of a three-car garage obstructing my view, which now, very easily, my neighbor could come, and if you pass this ordinance, could very easily, with the parking space they have currently designed for their single-family house, they could very easily now have a multifamily usage home. There are many cars that go in and out of that home, UPS vehicles, and traffic has increased. I don't know what else more I can say. I would appeal to you to reject this. I believe, as everybody else here does, that independent living space within a single-family dwelling for elderly family members is a laudable goal. But if it's done at the cost and the expense of property owners in the town of Cape Elizabeth, I think it's been probably ill-conceived and ill-advised. And, you know, I think all the problems that these people have addressed are very real. There is increased density, increased traffic, and all the other types of things we don't want in a single-family residential area. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Any other members of the public who wish to address the planning board? Yes, sir.
Thank you, members of the board. I, too, have a cold. Without reviewing, my name is Bob Goldman. I'm the other part of the terrible duo that wrote that letter that was quoted in the paper. And I'm fortunate to have a good friend like Greg Powell, who is also a very articulate lawyer. And I might say, Mr. Chairman, I sat in on a workshop where the issue of a letter involving neighbors printed on professional letterhead was raised, and I think that was a legitimate issue. I simply want to say that Greg represented us for those 3 years in court, and then the issue was raised again in 1992, and he wrote a letter about it to us. When the issue was raised again, I think it was his obligation to present it to us. I, too, am an attorney, and I'm the one that distributed the letter. So I think in this instance, it was certainly a justified use of the letterhead. And I'd like to make that clear.
Thank you.
I do not want to review the situation that we dealt with. It's very painful to go through that. I will merely say we just heard about a two-story building being raised in the Sherwood Forest area. We had a three-story building and a four-story building raised in our neighborhood on adjacent lots with a common driveway. And that is the background in which we dealt with the issue. I'd also like to say when I researched this issue a couple years ago for the courts, I don't know if the ordinance has changed since, but I came across an ordinance in one of the local towns where they specifically said that no dwelling unit should be less than 600 square feet. I also came across an ordinance, and I don't know if it's still in effect, in another town where they said that if you have more than one dwelling unit on a lot, that there should be 2.5 acres at least for each dwelling unit. So I think what we have here is a situation that many towns have a great deal of difficulty in dealing with. And I'll get into a little bit the business of looking in Nantucket, which is raised before. But it seems to me what we should do is look at what we have locally in southern Maine or elsewhere and see what people have been trying to do in dealing with this issue. Let me get into a couple other matters if I can. As Greg said, there is a confusion about the proposed ordinance, what its intent is, and who are the proposed beneficiaries. The original memo of the building inspector in February said that there was a need to provide for family members was on the increase, that the need to provide for family members was on the increase. The provision itself refers to the purpose to address affordable housing need. my understanding of affordable housing need, and whenever it's been in the newspaper, it has dealt with the business of trying to arrange for development of housing, that is, the building of homes for people of low and modest incomes. That's my view of affordable housing. And it's for the purpose of housing families who may not have the same resources as many of us. On October 1st, the Cape Courier article referred to a small accessory units as in-law apartments to provide independent living space within their home for an elderly relative. The Portland Press Herald just recently, apparently quoting town officials, said 600 square feet or less would be the size of a typical one-room efficiency apartment with enough space for one person. So I think there's a great deal of confusion about what the intent of this ordinance is. If there is a need, as Greg and others have said, we should be advised of extent and character. I think what we're entitled to know before we enter an area like this, which is a very serious import, it seems to me, for a town like Cape Elizabeth as well as other towns, we ought to have some sense of what the demand is, the need is, and so on, rather than just some random suggestion to us that there have been some requests for in-law apartments. Once we have that, then maybe we can look at the best way to deal with it, but at least we should know the extent of the problem. The question that arises in my mind is that there may be some request to take care of in-laws, an elderly parent or something like that. I have no question about that. The question arises, if that's an occasional request, then is the way to deal with it is to make a significant adjustment in the accessory apartment provision or the duplex provision, which really goes to the character of the town that we have. Unless there is a serious need, then perhaps there are other ways of dealing with the problem. Certainly, we have not neglected in the Cape the issue of taking care of elderly persons. And we have cluster developments and so on where many elderly residents are housed. And I think looking at the Nantucket situation is wholly improper. That's an isolated entity. We're part of a greater Portland community. There's no question in my mind that many residents of the Cape have elderly parents or in-laws or whatever that live in some housing somewhere in the greater Portland area, and they're able to visit them regularly. And so I suggest to you that the need has to be put in some sort of context. Relating it to Nantucket, it seems to me, is inappropriate. The other thing I'd like to say is I think there's a serious question of guarding against exploitation and misuse of the ordinance. The people at Sherwood Forest have referred to that. We had a considerable painful experience with being used under the guise of an in-law need. And as Greg indicated, most of us signed petitions or letters saying we're not opposed to a person taking care of an elderly aunt or an in-law. And I think that that's a universal sense in our society. But I think there's an issue of exploitation and misuse. I think that's the other side of the coin. Because once you put these apartments in, number one, it's not limited to in-laws or relatives. Anybody can apply who meets the standards. And they can house anybody they desire in that. So I think there is a serious question of exploitation and misuse, and if we do adopt it, it should not be done under the guise and the excuse that we're really dealing with an in-law or elderly parent situation. I think that we have to guard, and there aren't sufficient safeguards in here, we have to guard against a number of things. Number one, it seems to me, against informal enlargement, because that's one of the enforcement questions, it seems to me, that if you have a small 600-square unit, it seems to me it's almost impossible to house a couple or a small family in that. And it seems logical to me that a homeowner and the renter will find ways to informally enlarge that apartment, and that will become a de facto apartment. And I think there are other serious issues with it. I think also, I think, Maureen, you will find that in the current In the current ordinance, there is a 15,000 square foot limit. I think that's in section 7 of 19, 194D, I believe. And but I think the 1,500 square foot requirement, to me, just looks wholly arbitrary. I wonder if we have in the town data bank somewhere the dimensions of the various accommodations and houses in town, where we can draw upon that and get some useful information, or whether this was some ad hoc or random searching for some average type of apartment that might be useful. And I gather that it was a very informal methodology that arrived at this. I think it's arbitrary also because it excludes more modest homes who may have greater economic need to care for an elderly relative in the home. And also it includes those with larger homes or more modest lots and those with smaller homes on adequate lots. So I think we also find this situation on Richmond Terrace in our neighborhood. We have some small lots of 8,000, 7,000 square feet. We have some double lots. Those double lots would be 15,000 square feet. Those people presumably would be eligible for conversion to one of these, whereas the rest of the folks of the 8,000 square foot lots would not be. So I think it's quite arbitrary in the way it's crafted. I think we should not, if we're going to deal with an issue like this, we should not be bound by a limited exploration and examination both of the need for in-law accommodations and for our approach to it. I can't think of anything more important other than cosmic issues like the town center or making a four-lane highway out of the Spurwink than the issue of how we're going to affect the single-family residence character of the town. So I think that we should be more deliberate and more thoughtful about our approach to the situation. As I understand it, the Town Ordinance Committee, and I'll be finished for my sake shortly, as well as yours, the Town Ordinance Committee had a number of workshops. I think they had about five of them. And in looking at the notes from them, there are all kinds of ideas and issues and questions and language suggested. And it seems to me that if they went through that without any input from the public, then I think that it simply suggests that if we put this to some more deliberate kind of examination, we will come up perhaps with some better notions about the issue. Among the issues that they raised were one of how to define the floor area, which is one. The occupancy of the primary premises by the owner, and I think that's an issue. I don't think the owner of a premises of a 3,000 square foot house should set aside a 600 square foot unit. Maybe the house is in a very attractive zone. Live in the 600 square foot unit and rent out the rest of the house to somebody available and charge a very handsome rent for it. And I don't think the ordinance as crafted deals with that issue, but I think it is an issue. They raise a number of other issues. I think Mr. Clough, who from the Zoning Board, also consulted with the Ordinance Committee. And he at one point raised the issue of whether it could be limited to elderly, handicapped, or relatives, and whether it wasn't possible to craft an ordinance, not do away with the old ordinance, leave a duplex ordinance, but craft an ordinance that deals specifically with the in-law and relative in need issue. And I think that may be a possibility. Maybe it's unconstitutional. I don't know that. But it seems to me that we ought to know what we're dealing with and use our imagination in dealing with that situation. And there is just one other thing I would like to say. I think that whatever you do, you should make it clear that it should be by way of special exception or special use. Because what we faced when we went through our business was that the person that filed the application said, I have met the conditions of the code, period, and you've got to grant it. So I think you have to make it clear that this will be by way of special exception and not by way of right or by special permit. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Yes. Yes, sir. We are getting a little late in time. If people just simply want to support other opinions and state so and sit down, that's fine. not to put words in anyone's mouth.
I guess while the heat's up, I'd like to keep it up.
Go ahead.
You folks brought the issue up, so I'd ask you to listen for a little bit. My name is Arthur Hicks. For 20 years, I've lived at 26 Old Fort Road, Sherwood Forest. The last time I spoke to this group was on Ms. Wagner's duplex on the corner of Little John and Shore Road.
You didn't speak to this group. It was the zoning board.
Excuse me, the zoning board. But it was the only other reason in 20 years I felt that I had to come and plead my case before the town. I moved to Sherwood Forest because of the nature of the neighborhood, because it was a mature neighborhood with very few lots undeveloped. I felt that the aesthetics of the neighborhood was a proper fit with my family, and I felt quite confident that those aesthetics would not be disturbed because of the few lots. It had a consistent, high-quality, single-family home neighborhood atmosphere. Unlike the Wagners, and Ernie's been hit at a little bit here tonight, I was present when that building was framed up. The plumbing, the electrical, the floor plan is for a duplex. It is a duplex. Ernie stood from the street, looked at it with us, and said, there's nothing I can do about it. And we come to the point of enforceability. Unlike the Wagners, I came because it was an excellent neighborhood, quality of life, and it was a single-family neighborhood. Unlike the Wagners, I did not deceive the town and the neighbors. Several years ago when they built that, they affected the aesthetics of our neighborhood. They affected the values, not just the dollar values, but all the other values that run with a good quality single-family neighborhood. They designed and built a two-family house, walls, electric, plumbing, and then they challenged this town to accept it. They, in effect, pulled a sham on the town. They are not converting. They built it that way. They are just trying to get you folks to legalize it. They are back again with their sham, and every neighbor will be a victim. Unfortunately, in this day and age, with the attorneys that abound, the victims do not have the same rights that the perpetrators do. And I think if you folks allow this sham to go through, you're going to make a loophole in the law large enough to throw the house through. And the victims are going to be the other neighbors. And I'd ask that this does not go forward. Thank you.
Good, thank you. Yes, in the back, please.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. My name is Christine Pettinger. I live at 42 Hunts Point Road. I've been a resident of this town for about 8 years. I saw that this meeting was in the paper tonight, and it sparked my interest. I have come and read your revisions here, and I think this is an excellent idea. I am a registered nurse and have thought about what I could do to have a home business, what I could do in a few years when I get to retirement. I am living there with my son, who will be going to college and leaving the home, and I think that I could meet all these requirements. I think this is an excellent idea. I think it gives people who are getting older and will be retiring sometime within the next 10 years an opportunity where they could use their profession to maybe take an elderly person into their home and somehow have a home business. My home was also designed on one floor so that I myself would never have to go to a nursing home. And I think this is an excellent plan for opportunity for some of us in the town. Thank you.
Thank you.
I'm taking the unpopular point of view too. I think that the people who spoke.
You've already been before the podium. Out of courtesy, I'll allow you to continue, but please make it specific and brief.
Oh, brief?
Yeah, your comment before was that the lot size was too restrictive, if I remember correctly.
Yeah. I'm sorry, I'm partly deaf. Did you say be brief?
Excuse me?
Did you say be brief?
Brief, yes.
Okay. I think that the my last comment was brief, I think. The theory that it will lower property values and increase the population is very exaggerated. I think that if everybody in the Cape Elizabeth applied for the permit and divided their houses into two, I think that would be a problem. The number of applications would probably be something like about 1% of the entire population. So I think that the theory of lowering the property values is exaggerated. I feel that the ordinance may miss the mark, I haven't studied it, in that it deals with a lot of areas and restrictions, changes restrictions. I think that we are losing sight of the personal freedom aspect of people being able to look after an old person in their own home. I think that's a responsibility of a committee. One gentleman made the point that there hasn't been any public representation showing a demand for extra accommodation or creation of accessory dwellings. But because there hasn't been a demand from the public generally, it doesn't mean to say it's not right. You could say the same thing about a minority group being protected by a responsible body. The minority group is protected by a responsible body regardless of public clamour. So there's a personal freedom situation here where somebody should be able to change the inside of their house to provide a kitchen for an elderly person or alternatively another relative for some reason. That's a personal freedom issue, which is very important. All it amounts to is putting an extra kitchen in, and possibly the regulation should be aimed at something like preserving the existing profile so that the architectural character is not changed for the surrounding neighbourhood. I'm just as interested in keeping the property value as everybody else. I live here. But there is a very important point of personal freedom.
Okay, I have to interrupt there. I don't want to get into the point where everyone who's spoken now needs to get back up and rebut your comments, but is there anyone who hasn't spoken yet? Yes, in the back.
My name is Lois Grocki, and I live at 293 Mitchell Road. I agree that I think it's two different issues, the issue of affordable housing as opposed to the issue of, say, an in-law apartment or helping elderly relatives. I don't want to speak to the specifics or details of the plans, but I would like to just speak to the fact that I think we need to consider people who do need help for their families, and that if this isn't the way, that we don't just throw it out and not address the issue. I think a lot of people may not have spoken up about a need. I think there is a need. For me, there's a personal need. I think because we have fine homes or good educations, we're not exempt from being struck by tragedy or people being ill or our relatives getting older. I wouldn't want to have to leave Cape Elizabeth because I want to live here and this is where I want to raise my children. But I think we could make it very difficult for people to have an in-law apartment or to have their relatives there, and that we need to really think about that. And I think that the fact that a lot of people aren't coming forth and saying they need them speaks to the fact that the neighborhoods aren't going to be just inundated with these in-law apartments. I think they are separate issues with affordable housing, and I just wanted to get up and say we really should not stop looking at the issue. And for the people that live here and need it, I think we need to find a way to do it.
Thank you. Any other members of the public? Yes, ma'am.
I have no notes.
Betty Crane, 2 Apen Road. I feel that we've got too many issues here. We've not only got affordable housing and in-law apartments, and who's to say what an in-law is? It can be a sister-in-law or an elderly in-law. We've also got this work thing. So I feel strongly, I personally am very opposed to changing the character of our single-family neighborhoods. But the bottom line tonight is I feel very strongly that we're not ready to face this thing. I think it's got to be studied. You've just got to go back to the drawing board, and I hope you will. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Anyone else? Seeing none, I'll close the public hearing. Before we continue, I would like to thank everyone who's come before the podium and fully encourage all of you to make the same presentation to the council, regardless how the board votes this evening. I appreciate the tone of the presentation, and I appreciate the range of the comments. With that, I'll turn to the board. We have quite a few items. Before we get into discussions, I want to be sure that there is not confusion with respect to what this ordinance is doing. There was a comment made late in the presentation, in the public hearing, that one wanted to use the in-law apartment to create a home business. This specifically does not allow that, so that comment is a bit misdirected. I will also ask, we have many, many comments, and I don't know that each one of them warrants going down item by item. That there were more clear beliefs and concerns than they were questions of the board. I heard them clearly, and I trust all the other board members did too. We have been deliberating this issue for some time now, and we've been looking for exactly this type of public input. Maureen would like to comment with respect to language in the ordinance regarding lot size or unit size.
Just to address Mr. Goldman's comment, the current ordinance does require that if your existing house is served by sewer, you have to have a minimum lot size of 15,000 square feet, and it says, or greater if served by septic. What happens, in fact, is it says, if served by septic or you can meet the state plumbing code. What happens on a regular basis is that people, because of the state plumbing code, can come in and get approval for their septic system for under 15,000 square feet. So when reviewing this, it seemed to make no sense at all to require someone to go 15,000 if they're on sewer, and ended up, in effect, going lower than 15,000 on septic, when actually you should be going the other way around. What the proposal set basically is saying now is that go to the sewage ordinance. We took the whole sewage language out of the proposal because it just didn't make sense. The sewage ordinance makes sense. So we just said you have to meet the sewage, the town sewage ordinance. And so I left that out because I felt that while the ordinance said 15,000 square feet, in fact, as it ended up being, it was often less than that.
Thank you. At this point, I'd like to, we have quite a range of ways we can proceed this evening, and the board has been wavering on discussions recently in workshop in the past regular meeting, and what I'd like to do is open it up for board discussion and see if we can set a direction. Just simply to say to the public that the one of the issues that the board is faced with here is that we've been handed an ordinance that could pass the council as is, and if the board was simply to table this or to refer it to the council with no comment, there's always a concern that it would be approved that way by the council. So we're faced with several different approaches, and I'd like to have the board discuss those and see if we can come to some consensus at this evening's meeting. Any comments? No comments.
No.
Mr. Edsel.
I just don't like to go first every time.
No, that's
giving people their options. The last time we met and talked about this, we've spent a lot of time dealing with the technical changes in the amendment, and I think my own sense on the board was that we get to this point where we felt very uneasy about the end result that we're coming up with, and I compliment the public comment, whether I agreed with it or not. I've been on the board for 6 years, I think, and we just ache for public comment so we know what people's opinions really are. Sometimes there are issues where we can't follow all of that advice, but we certainly like to hear it. The major concern that I have, not quite sure of the option that I'm in favor of right now, but on the podium tonight was a letter from Mike Hill. We've wavered back and forth on this issue of enforceability of owner occupancy, and I think some of the comment tonight by attorneys and others reinforced the letter that we got tonight. Now, we had not, it had been unclear to us whether the town attorney felt this was unenforceable. At one time, he remained kind of mute to the issue and didn't respond. We were unsure. It appears that he's come back to us in this letter dated the 18th saying that his opinion is that it is unenforceable to state that it's an owner-occupied unit. I think that the intent of the council in passing this down to us was twofold. One, to fulfill the comprehensive plan, which does state that they would like to readdress the issue of accessory unit. And number two, affordable housing. I think that the tie to affordable housing is misguided. I think the issue of providing living space for family members or related members is an important role in all neighborhoods. The fact that we don't create another unit does not mean that other family members can't come and live with any one of us. It simply says it can't create a different living unit. In other words, it can't have a separate bathroom, separate kitchen. It can't be a self-contained unit. Now, there are lots of examples where other family members come to live with a family unit, and they share those facilities. As one board member, I will not be in favor tonight of passing this on as to recommend these changes. But I'm unsure, and I'd like to hear from other board members what approach we take, whether we say we table it tonight, take it back for discussion, and just simply how do we take it back to the council, or we simply respond to the council and say, we don't recommend this change at all. I think, in my mind, those are the two options.
Thank you. There is, not to prompt any of the board members, but for the public's information, there is language for a motion that, in essence, states that the board may pass on the amended ordinance without recommending it, and that's our parachute. That is that if you're going to go ahead and pass this, these are the suggestions we make. We feel these are improvements to the one you have, but we're not recommending that you pass the ordinance. Following with Steve's, Mr. Edsel's comments, are there any other concerns, comments from the board? Mr. Parkhurst.
I too do not feel that I can, in fact, certainly know I cannot vote to have passed this on and recommend it. And so I will be voting to not recommend. And as to taking it back for further discussion, I don't think unless we go back to what it was before that we're going to be able to move things around in any way, shape, or manner that's going to appease the citizens of this town or myself as a board member.
Any other comments? Thank you. Any other board comments? Ms. McKay?
Mr. Chairman, I feel somewhat at a disadvantage since I've only been attending one workshop meeting before this meeting tonight. I guess I was somewhat surprised at the, shall I say, lopsided comments of so many of the public being concerned about the passage in any way, shape, or form of the proposed section. And I think that there certainly is a conflict among the purposes of the elderly on the one hand, or the in-law situation, and the affordable housing aim on the other. But I, for one, would like to, I guess perhaps I would simply like to have more of a chance to grapple with what it is that I would like to see recommended, and I would be reluctant to simply have it drop here without some kind of determination on our side.
You mean reluctant to see it tabled?
Yes.
Yes. Thank you.
No, I actually wouldn't mind seeing it tabled until another meeting where we could decide in some, if we need further time to discuss it, then fine. I guess what I would like not to see is for us to simply say that we would not recommend it in any way, shape, or form to the council.
I see. Thank you. Mr. Parkhurst?
In the memorandum that came with the revisions, the town council has asked us for a recommendation be forwarded back to them by November 1st. Seems that we're sort of running out of time. How cast in stone is that November 1st date?
It's not unusual for the board to ask the council for extensions on anything they've asked you to comment on. So I can't say the council will be happy or welcome a request for an extension, but it's certainly been done many times before.
Thank you.
Sure. Mr. Edsel.
I think to pass a motion that this is return this to the council with no recommendation, we're skirting our job, what we should be doing, and I would urge us to take it back to workshop, if for no other reason than to take a look at the existing ordinance again as it stands and correct, if we do nothing other than correct some of the inadequacies or the loopholes in the existing ordinance as it stands without what was termed tonight to be a lessening of the restrictions to that. Take it as a more basic, I guess in general, a more radical response and say what's there is more acceptable. There need to be some minor changes made to that, but otherwise not so.
Thank you. Mr. Wilcox?
Impression of the new information in the memo from the town attorney has kind of gone to the heart of something that I felt was a fundamental basis of the ordinance as drafted, which was the ability to specify owner occupation. And to have this kind of drop into my lap at the 11th hour, I think makes me question what I thought was the other fundamental aspect of it, which was not that you're looking at an affordable housing unit, but you're looking at, and not really even at one homeowner, but you're looking at affordability as a family concern. And if all of a sudden the owner drops out of the situation, then that whole basis for my evaluation of this proposed change is kind of thrown into doubt. So I think I also would like to explore what options we might have of firming something up out of it.
Okay. Thank you. Mr. Carlson.
One of the things that's kind of hit my mind through all the workshops here is the word affordable housing. And that right away directs us to look at low-rent housing or an inexpensive way or a way of making an income. But I think also that the basic objective of all this is to somehow provide accommodations for those people that are close to us or who need it. So I think that the idea of tabling this and reworking the existing ordinance might be a good idea. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Reworking the existing ordinance, not revising right. The draft that was sent before.
That was mentioned by Mr. Wilcox, I believe.
Okay.
As I understood him, I...
Whatever.
I guess I... any other comments from other board members? I once again want to really thank the presentation from the public. Mm-hmm. It was very professional, mm-hmm. well-mannered, and I think it makes it much easier for the board to hear your concerns and comments. I live in a neighborhood very much like the neighborhood you described, Robin Hood neighborhood, and I've seen things going on in our neighborhood where all of a sudden another side door shows up. I don't have any proof that there's an in-law living over the garage or there's not a permit, and I frankly haven't taken the time to find out. But it's sort of the cumulative effect of that, and Cape Elizabeth residents, I believe, are a very sensitive lot. If they get the sense that something's wrong in their neighborhood and nothing happens with it, sooner or later you'll get flight out of that neighborhood or you'll have other changes in the property values. I think if the intent of the ordinance is to deal with the elderly population, as I said before, there's no doubt that there's a tremendous social change going on in this country and the state in particular. I have personal experience of a relative who was recently retired, who had an old family house down in Massachusetts and didn't need to move in with in-laws. What that aunt needed to do was to have people move in and share the house with her so she could afford to continue to pay the highly escalating property taxes on a fixed income. The house was not converted. There was no sense of it being other than a single-family house. That's something that wasn't discussed this evening. Again, I don't know if there's a lot of demand for that in Cape Elizabeth, but I can imagine at some point, if people don't have pensions and they're on fixed incomes, that can become a concern. The other concern is a very clear one. That is the notion of the extended family, that an in-law, a mother-in-law, or father-in-law, let's use the example of a mother-in-law, moves into the house simply because women tend to live longer than men. It wasn't unusual a generation ago to have grandparents and parents living in the same household, have them living on separate floors and not having it a three-family house. In many cases in Massachusetts, they were three-family houses. I have relatives who came over from Europe and three generations stayed in the same house, and the letters remarking about that, about the fourth generation attending the same school, are remarkable letters to read. But the concern is that how is one protected from that? And the issue of the letter being on our desk tonight saying that it's unenforceable with respect to relatives or owner occupancy is a real concern of mine. A concern that wasn't raised at this evening's meeting but I've seen happen in my neighborhood is the issue of single-family houses being rented, that people buy them, don't move into them, and rent them out. And that's perhaps even a more dire situation where you have, if you have well-behaved neighbors who maintain the property well, that's one thing. You have the opportunity for four or five automobiles in the driveway and several boats. That can continue, as far as I understand, regardless of what happens with this ordinance. The two are not tied together at all. Lastly, if the concern is the issue of affordability, I don't mean affordable housing. I mean people who, where there is a demonstrated need that either they need, in essence, a subsidy of their property taxes or they need to accommodate relatives in the house. The first comment that was raised at the public hearing was one that I raised at a workshop, and that is, where in the world did this 15,000 square foot number come from for the lot size? There is no 15,000 square foot lot in the ordinance. My neighborhood tends to range, the largest lot would be 15, typically they're around 10 to 12,000. I was amazed when I heard the number 10,000, that's the size of my lot. And being a designer, I did a little sketch, and I couldn't see any difference in the impact in the neighborhood from a 15,000 square foot lot to a 12,000 square foot lot. So I think the comment regarding the issue of whether or not the ordinance is well researched and is a good one, and whether the demand is being addressed, that's a real concern that I have. The greater concern is if the ordinance is not amended, is that it leaves the opportunity for larger houses to be subdivided and. No one's need is being met other than the density is increasing. We have no assurances of the elderly. Picking up on the other board's comments with respect to a possible tabling, I was hoping that perhaps we could move this ahead this evening simply from the standpoint that I would like to get it back into the council's hands. At our last regular meeting of the board, we had just come from a workshop deliberation and the light had really gone on at that point. We attacked this from a technical standpoint. We had an opportunity at our last regular meeting to step back and see the bigger issue. And I think to a great extent through the influence of Mr. Parkhurst and some of his comments, we therefore went back to our workshop meeting this month and discussed it further. And I was hoping that perhaps when we came to this meeting, we might have we might be ready to address the issue and make a decision one way or the other, but I'll leave that up to the board through the motion process. With a comment, I'll ask if there are any additional board comments, If not, would anyone care to make a motion? Mr. Park, Mr. Edsel.
I have a motion for the board to consider. Be it ordered that, based on the comments and the facts presented, the proposed accessory dwelling unit revisions to the zoning ordinance be tabled until the next scheduled meeting of the Planning Board for further review and consideration.
Second.
Motion first and seconded. All those in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed? Carries 3-2. So this will go back to workshop. Again, the workshops are public meetings. Anyone who wishes to attend can do so. We don't typically allow public comment, but you're invited to listen and as you please.
Should part of that motion be that we request additional time from the town council in order to do that?
I think just as additional discussion that it's a courtesy to the town council when we don't meet a set timetable that the chair respond to the chair of the council saying, because of this reason, I think if we state that the reason is after the response of a public hearing, they would be very glad to hear that we're going back. I mean, they've encouraged us to take the public response a great deal. It is not uncommon, as Maureen said, to surpass a deadline date. The affordable housing ordinance, for instance, was during my chairship, 1 year past the requested due date. And as long as we're working diligently on it, I think they understand.
I will do so. Again, thank the public very, very much. At this point, we haven't made a decision as whether we would go back for another public hearing, but we will be back before a regular meeting in November. With that, we'll move on to the next item on my agenda. Next item under new business is Fleet Bank facade changes. Fleet Bank is located in Pond Cove Shopping Center, is requesting approval for facade changes, and the code enforcement officer has determined that site plan review is required. Before Maureen makes an introduction, I have two comments. The first of which is that the plans have been prepared by Portland Design Team. I'm with Terrien Architects in Portland. We are associated with Portland Design Team on the design of the middle schools. There are three architectural firms, and Portland Design Team is the lead team. Essentially, each project is run independently. Portland Design Team has the ultimate authority and the ultimate financial responsibility. I have no financial ties to Portland Design Team. I feel I should disclose this, but I don't feel uncomfortable, unless any of the other board members do, about dealing with this, discussing this item tonight. Is there any other concern?
No objection. Okay.
The other item issue is that this was presented originally under the consent agenda, or had been requested to be placed on the consent agenda. In all honesty, it probably is a classic case of a project that would end up on the consent agenda except for its location. And I think some comments that the board may want to raise with respect to the design issues of the project. And I wanted to give the board the ability to go through that process and not feel necessary not to comment on it simply because it was on the consent agenda. The last time that we had a consent agenda that was approved very quickly with no discussion, so I just wanted to be sure if there were any opportunity for discussion that could be had. With that,
Mr. Chair?
Yes, Mr. Edsel.
Technically, I'm still an employee of Fleet Bank, formerly separated but through a reduction in staff from Fleet. But technically not terminated yet, and I still receive income from Fleet Bank. While I don't see it as a conflict of interest as such, certainly it could be construed to be as such. I think the issue of bias would come up, and maybe justifiably so, if I were to vote in a negative fashion on this. So for that reason, I'd request to be recused from.
Okay, thank you. Maureen, would you give a brief introduction? Again, there are a couple of issues here with respect to completeness and then deliberation.
As Tom stated, originally I worked with...
Do you want to appoint Mr. Carlson?
I'm sorry. Thank you. Mr. Carlson, would you please get a vote on this item?
The applicant originally met with me, and we had hoped to place this on the consent agenda. We have since turned it into a complete site plan review. What you have in front of you is, first of all, a summary of completeness, and that is attached on the back of this. There is no comment from the town engineer, and again, that's because it was originally a consent agenda item. I have to say that there really isn't any items here that the town engineer would be concerned about. It's such a minor exterior change that no change to the traffic circulation, no change to stormwater control, so there really are no engineering issues. There is also a very short review here of the actual site plan review, so what the board could do is check over the completeness, then determine whether or not you want a public hearing. If you choose to hold a public hearing, it would have to be scheduled for next month. You're not required to hold a public hearing. If you choose not to hold a public hearing, you can jump right into the standards, and if you feel it meets the standards, it could be voted on this evening. What I'd probably do, unless there's any questions on the completeness checklist, is just to turn it over to the applicant.
Are there any questions with respect to completeness?
No.
I have none. Proceed.
My name is Eva Kozlovsky. I'm working for Portland Design Team, and I came here to represent Fleet Bank with its application. Project, it's very small. I mean, just the size of the board and the small area that describes where the work is actually going to happen. Just the bank is located in a small shopping center since early 70s, and I think it's in almost in the same original form. And as a result of continuing public requests for ATM service, Fleet Bank is planning to install one machine in the bank vestibule. In order to accommodate new ATM, some small changes had to be made to the existing vestibule, which presently doesn't meet ADA standards. And since the original construction materials do not meet energy efficiency standards, heat loss, moisture, penetration, and condensation were causing substantial damages to the interior and causing a certain level of discomfort for bank employees and bank customers. With this new design, we had to address certain requirements, like, as I mentioned, ADA accessibility, minimum clearances for door closes, entry mat. Requested ATM, in order to provide enough space in the bank for employees and customers, we were forced to move the facade of the building out towards the sidewalk, but still staying within the existing building footprint. Exterior wall will be aligning with the underside of the existing fascia, which will not be altered. We are not encroaching the existing sidewalk, which now is about 5'6" wide. Design also took under consideration energy efficiency. Walls were designed with a minimum R19 value and glass is insulated. That's what the bank asked us to improve. I don't know how many of you really know the size and the shape of the bank inside. We're quite limited within the size what we could actually do to accommodate all those needs. I have this very brief sketch of can you see anything from that? This sketch just shows how inefficient space is. In order to put ATM and also meet the code for the size of the handicap vestibule, we were forced to move that wall about 3'6" towards the face of the building. Another consideration for location of ATM, that's the problem with getting approval today, is its security for the bank. The original design is mostly glass. The facade is glass. But the machine itself requires service area And this area has to be protected with some kind of enclosure. And we picked brick as a material that was already happening within the shopping center. Shopping center doesn't have many quality materials right now, so we felt that taking brick as one of the elements would maybe not dress up much of the exterior, but it definitely would bring maybe some quality to the overall appearance. And still, keeping it small, I understand that the area of brick is larger than maybe many of you would like to see. But we were forcing to remove the existing concrete planters, which actually serve primarily as bollards or wheel stops to protect glass front. So we decided to build a short brick wall with windows, which would protect the building from snow pileup and would resist eventual impact of the skidding vehicle. So the reason for the small short wall is to actually serve some kind of more practical function. That's pretty much it in terms of the design intent, why we did what we did. The way building is set up and with the functions within the bank, we didn't want to alter any counter, teller counters, anything. We just were concentrated pretty much on the facade of the building to meet those functions that I mentioned before.
Okay.
Any questions?
No, I think just to keep the procedure straight here, what I'd like to do is have a vote on completeness so that we can at least say that we've deemed something complete before we've had substantive discussion. I entertain a motion.
Move that the application be deemed complete.
Second.
All those in favor, raise your right hand. Passes unanimously. Okay, now that it's been deemed complete, do we have any questions of the applicant? Any discussions?
Can I ask a question of Maureen? I think I must have missed something in the introduction, but why was this brought to us as opposed to a de minimis change?
There was a concern on behalf of the planning board chair that this it was not as free of questions as the previous consent agenda items. And I think in order to I think there was a general agreement that the consent agenda process is working well. And in order to preserve that process, we really only want to put items on the consent agenda that are free from any questions. I think if the only question that relates to this is one that I discussed with the applicant, and that was the replacement of a large area that is currently glass with wall space.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm not talking about the area underneath the windows that are proposed, but the area where the ATM will be, which is essentially going to be a blank brick wall.
Mm-hmm.
And there was some question about whether or not that would be something the board would be concerned about.
Is anyone concerned?
Is there also a question about taking up space on the sidewalk? I still can't tell. Is the existing wall of the bank is now going to be moved forward 3.5 feet?
To align with the rest of the of those two properties, actually, adjacent to the
so
bank.
The door would then go out onto the sidewalk?
Yes.
And
mm-hmm.
doorways
yes.
on the adjoining properties
yes.
also go out on the
yeah.
sidewalk?
Mm-hmm.
Some do, some don't.
Mm.
Just to follow up on that, have you confirmed that is the lease line that that the wall is extending to?
Yes.
It is.
We are staying within the building structure because actually the structure of the building, the way building originally it's designed, there is a structural wall supporting the beam going across. So actually when you look at this building, this is like a recessed vestibule or porch that we're actually asking just to move the wall out to the structural line of the building.
Any other questions? Well, we have a registered architect here, and he's passing. I'll jump in. I think Mr. Parkhurst's question is a valid one, and I think if it Again, I guess I'm holding Portland Design Team to a higher standard than I would somebody else who came before the board who was just marketing metal buildings. And picking up on Maureen's concern, I see very clearly what the functional requirement is in terms of a solid wall. My concern is there any other alternative within those limitations where the building entrance, if I could back up just a minute, banks were once sort of the center and focus of a community. I've heard a comment that they're now only concerned with the bottom line, and that community is involvement is much different than it used to be because of the much wider competition. But as I travel across the state, I really am amazed at sort of the inattention to branch offices that act as community focal points, and I think it's probably because many of them have ended up U.S. routes, to, you know, in strip areas and so forth, where they've converted old steakhouses and so forth. But when I looked at the elevation that's being presented, and I look at the existing building has some pretty clear statements about the design approach, and the elevation that we have before us this evening, I think more of a very traditional, not fast food, convenience store, where you have a door in the middle and windows on each side, and again, minimizing the window area so that you maximize the shelf space inside the building along the perimeter wall. First of all, let's ask the question, is it possible, and I'm going to step beyond the normal site plan review bounds of the board, but I think this has some significant ramifications for the town center, and we're trying to bring the shopping center, keep the shopping center. We're encouraging business, but if there's an opportunity to continue to make the shopping center even better, we'd like to be part of that process. The doors are centered between the two windows. I guess the question I have is it typical, and that's the way it is at Casco Northern Bank in the Old Port. And what I notice is when people come into the bank, they're passing by the person using the ATM. Does it make any sense to move the doors farther to the left in your plan or in the elevation so that you have a greater expanse of glass combined and then you have the door away from the ATM users?
We looked at that possibility, but unfortunately the way the handicap counter is located in the bank, which is right here, would make the circulation very difficult for a handicapped person to be actually using that counter and door swinging because it's a very deep vestibule. It's about 7 foot clear. I understand that this is right now become kind of like a design review, and I sympathize. I'm not pleased with what I had to do. Mm-hmm. I represent 108 Fleet Bank projects in the state of Maine. We have very strict budget how much we can, what we can do, and money cannot buy much those days. Every single project has to be approved not only by one level of approval process within a bank, but even two, three, four layers, and every single layer asking, can you trim a little bit more? So brick usually is not the least expensive building material. So in order to achieve anything more than we did, we would have to go through some additional approvals and changes, and I doubted if we would be successful.
Is there any discussion about a recessed panel in the broad brick expanse? Just offsetting
like brick?
The brick? Just something that gives the, maybe picks up on
the brick
pattern? Or
the only two things, we're kind of creating like two pilasters, brick pilasters on both ends. Right now they're made of some kind of vertical wood board. We're trying to eliminate that and create a little bit like a solid maybe appearance. And then I think it's about 2-3 inches difference between those two planes. This is only one interest I could offer at that time. But of course, if that's something that would make you all, you know, happy and approve, I'll try to change some of the, maybe brick would make some other statement than just plain wall.
Well, I hate to ask this question. Is there a color on the frames?
Color is to match existing, whatever we have already in adjacent property, which is the kinder corner or something, mm-hmm. which I think is a bronze finish.
Okay. Well, I was hoping for more, but it doesn't. I'm out of bounds of the health, safety, and welfare right now.
Well, original design was just hollow metal frames. We fought for some nice aluminum, and we won. So we tried to improve it as much as we could.
Thank you for much.
Those are small battles, but if you have 108 of them, it's a lot of work.
It's all, you know, it's also the proportion of the windows that remain. It's just, it's...
Mr. Chairman, I do sympathize with you. I guess I just don't know enough about how we could...
I guess the reason, the only purpose of this meeting this evening, rather than being on the consent agenda, is to implore you to go back to your firm and maybe a box of donuts and say, let's roll up our sleeves and the tightest budget projects, the ones that squeak the most, the ones that often really provide the greatest design challenge and solutions.
It would be very difficult for me to convince Frank Locker about this approach.
I won't say any more on that issue. With that, any other comments or questions?
Maybe the thing that would break up the facade a little bit, and just a little quick suggestion, is maybe to have divided lights in the window. Because you do have a lot of flat planes there, even though the brick wall is only 7 feet, 8 inches across. Mm-hmm. But it is just all one sort of boring facade. But if you broke it up with divided lights, it might add a little character to it. Other than that, I have nothing to say.
Okay.
From a safety issue, would it be better to have the panels of glass be further down toward the floor?
Excuse me, I missed the point.
The question was, for safety purposes, would it be better to have the panels of glass closer to the floor?
In other words, more elongated?
More visibility into the ATM area. Is that what you're thinking of?
Yes.
I believe you have to have an 18-inch minimum, don't you?
I'm not sure if that's a requirement, but since, you know, we're removing bollards, and I know that curb in front of the bank, it's so minimal, about 1.5 inches. There is a serious concern about having somebody actually missing that small bump and just keep going and going. So we thought maybe visual barrier, having some small brick 2 foot 8 inches high, would just give enough attention to stop. There's just so much you can do, and we looked at many possibilities. And sorry.
All right, you've convinced us. do we have to discuss the public hearing? At this point, do we have a motion? Is there anyone seeing any need for a public hearing?
No.
No.
But thank you for asking.
All right. With that, I'll entertain a motion.
I'll make a motion.
Mr. Parkhurst.
Findings of fact, number one, Fleet Bank is proposing changes to the branch bank facade of the Pond Cove Shopping Center, which requires site plan review by the Planning Board. Number two, the application was deemed complete at the October 18, 1994 meeting of the Planning Board. The Board chose not to hold a public hearing. Number three, the application substantially complies with site plan standards section 19-2-10. Therefore, be it ordered that based on plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the request of Fleet Bank for facade changes to its branch located at the Pond Cove Shopping Center be approved.
Second.
Second. Motion second. Any discussion? All those in favor, please raise your right hand. Passes unanimously. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Last item on this evening's agenda. Where'd that agenda? Here we are. Here's one. The associate member, it must be 910, the associate member status of the zoning amendment. Let's see. At our last workshop, I believe we discussed and we polled this issue with respect to whether or not it's better to have an associate member who uses a one-year internship, so to speak, to become acclimated to the board, and that 1 year of service is then easier for the appointments committee to review or whether it made, and that associate member is able to freely discuss projects as the rest of the board members, only that the associate member is not able to vote unless there is an absentee of a regular member and the associate is appointed to vote. As you recall, we had a board member who left the board specifically because after 1 year he was not appointed as a regular member and decided to resign. As part of the LURP Land Use Regulation Review Committee process, that concern regarding an associate member's not being appointed a regular member in lieu of, let me back up. The situation is this, is that an associate member can serve endlessly on a board as an associate member, and a regular member who decides to resign was not automatically replaced by an associate member, but could have been replaced by a new person placed on the board by the appointments committee. As it stands now, associate members, the next one in line, moves into any vacancy on the board. The council, debated the issue of planning board and zoning board having seven regular members. One of the notions is that if the council comes ready to fight out of the ready to vote out of the starting gate, then all other boards, community boards, should. I presented the two opposing discussions that the planning board has had, that there are some associate members who've appreciated the opportunity for internship, whether they're new to the community or just new to the process. And the other issue, of course, as I stated, is that members, some associate members want to be involved immediately in the voting process. The council seemed to be split on the issue. One councilor, at least, is adamant that there's a vote, all members are voting members, and another councilor was concerned that the Land Use Regulation Process Review Committee's recommendation to continue the associate membership status not be overlooked. At this point, the council will be taking this up in November and has asked us to make a recommendation regarding the Planning Board and the Zoning Board at this evening's meeting. With that, I'll ask Maureen to add any other additional information.
Just to make it a little bit more interesting, I'll bring up the procedure in the zoning ordinance is that any amendment to the zoning ordinance has to be forwarded to the planning board. The board has 45 days to comment on it before the council can consider approval of it. So this is part of the formal request for an amendment. So in considering this tonight, you need to formally request this amendment. You need to decide whether or not you want to hold a public hearing. And if you choose to hold a public hearing, then you can't meet the council's deadline for their November meeting. So it kind of throws a little wrench in how you're able to comment something that council will be considering.
Where are we in the 45-day process?
I'd have 5 days, that's right. So it would be better if somehow we could expedite this. Just to make this a little bit more interesting, the only board that is affected by the zoning ordinance is the zoning board. The associate status of the planning board and or the conservation commission is not even referenced in the zoning ordinance. So the council can change that at will. They can change the status of the planning board. You don't need to comment on that part. It's the zoning board part you need to comment on, because their structure is outlined in the zoning ordinance. Everybody else is in the boards and commissions ordinance. So what would probably be good for the board to do tonight, if possible, is to exercise your formal obligation to comment on an amendment to the zoning ordinance, i.e. zoning board associate members. Secondly, to take advantage of the request that's been made to you to comment on your own status. And third, in this same package is another amendment that talks about increasing the limit on the terms that a board member can serve, 2 to 3. And again, this is not something you have to comment on. Yeah. It's not something anyone has to ask you what your opinion is. But yeah, you may want to take this opportunity to comment on the limit
and increasing that term limit from 2 to 3. Is that clear or more confusing?
Is that clear?
Relatively clear, but what was the reason that that LERP decided to recommend that the associate status remain, that the associate members remain associate?
The LERP committee had, Mr. Edsel and I both served on that, and there were several members from other, from the Zoning Board Conservation Commission, and in that environment, the discussion the consensus was that people benefited from the associate position. That discussion seemed to outweigh the concern for not being able to vote. Mr. Edsel.
I would just say it was by consensus, and I didn't agree with that point of view. I didn't consent.
Thank you. I guess that opens up our eyes. Okay. With that, is there any discussion? Mr. Edsel.
Since what we say really doesn't, we can't take action on the boards and commissions ordinance. I correct. Make the recommendation that we too be salaried. For what it's worth, maybe then we would be willing to charge for the all voting members from day one.
I guess we have to go into closed session then. We got to talk numbers.
The only other comment that I have is on the last page, statement of policy appointments, the standing boards and commissions. Just a suggestion that it may read more clearly, take the phrase "a citizen previously served on" off the end of that second sentence and just change reappointment of that citizen to the same board or committee may then occur only after da 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 da. Strike the last. I think that's a dangling phrase.
Mm-hmm. Any other? Ms. McKay?
You've talked about citizens and talked about members, so maybe just take off the last five words on the end of the sentence and not add anything up above.
As long as it's clear, the citizen or member doesn't, because that is mentioned above, as long as it's clear that reappointment to the same board or committee is clear. But I think that's...
reappointment to that same board or commission may then occur only after a 1 year. That's the way to do it.
Yes.
I guess my only comment on the merits is that when I first got appointed to the planning board 4 years ago or whatever, I came on at the same time that several other people did. And I'm not sure exactly why, but I think because a lawyer was going off the board, I got appointed to a full seat to start off with. And it was a pretty steep learning curve, no question about it. But it certainly forced me to pay attention, and I guess I don't really have a strong feeling one way or the other, but I guess I do have some preference for, especially since I'm in the associate position now, being able to vote. I guess that's what the bottom line is. But from a larger, trying to take the larger point of view, I guess it really is a tough one because I don't have a strong background in land use matters, and it really was a fairly steep learning curve. But by the same token, I think we're all asked to weigh the facts and listen to people and ask whatever questions we need to ask. And one vote out of seven wouldn't be something that would necessarily sway things too much of the time. But I don't think I have a strong feeling.
Mr. Parker's? I'm sorry, Mr. Parker.
Would this necessitate any other changes in the way we vote or anything like that? Because I think there's a majority. Is it a simple majority, or is it three of the five voting members? I don't know if there's a number attached either way.
I actually thought about that. I think it does make a difference.
Yeah, there's a difference in the quorum, and there's a difference.
Your minutes, your rules right now say that a quorum is four.
Oh, it does?
Yes.
So that would,
and you need a majority of a quorum.
So you'd need four at least.
Majority of the people voting. to pass something.
So you'd need at least three?
Right.
Or if, yeah.
So if you had all seven people here, then you would have to have four?
Yes.
So actually, are you saying then that there would be no change in the quorum and no change in the amount of votes needed to pass?
Like I said, right now, your rules say the quorum is four people. So, and it says that to pass something, you need a majority of the people voting.
Okay. So there really would be no changes necessary.
Well, the other thing is, your planning board rules are due for some revisions anyway, since the terms were changed from ending in March to ending in December. Your planning board rules say that you elect officers in March, and obviously you should elect them in January now. So, I mean, if there are things in here that are going to be inconsistent with the rules, we could certainly wrap them up into that provision which is coming up.
Well, that made me wonder why I guess the zoning ordinance says specifically that the zoning board can make its own rules, but there aren't any other, there's nothing that says anything about the planning board or anything else in terms of making rules. But that's not a big deal.
Very quickly, my only comment is and as it always has been, on the associate member, that from the first meeting, an associate member can be asked to vote, and all members can abstain from voting. Mm-hmm. Any member can abstain.
That issue was discussed. I thought that was a real good point. That came up at the workshop, and I raised that issue to the council, and a councilor felt that no member should go, other than conflict of interest, no member should go to a planning board meeting who would abstain because of lack of preparation or lack of information on the subject, that everyone should be fully informed and ready to vote if they're all voting members. Therefore, if there's this tendency to need to do that, then perhaps the associate member has some purpose. But again, that there's debate back and forth on the council on that issue, but I think that's a very good point. Mr. Carlson.
Mr. Chairman, associate member having that position continue may discourage people applying to the positions on the zoning board and to boards where we still have associate membership, only because people want to serve. They want to put their time to it. They want to have some impact on what the decisions are being made. And as I understand it, we do suffer some problems here in filling some spots on some of the boards. I don't know whether that's true for the conservation or it's on the zoning board. I think it was somewhat true here. The other thing is associate member may, over a period of time, get somewhat, well, I'll do it, but maybe I won't, maybe I'll do it, maybe I'll be there, maybe I won't. He's got tremendous freedom as composed to the other members as far as responsibility is concerned. So, though it was a good experience for me, and it is, and I have applied again for next year, I really think that full voting of the board would probably be the best idea. Thank you.
Thank you. I guess I have to designate a voting associate here. I'll ask Ms. McKay to vote on this item.
Is that a conflict of interest?
If I didn't appoint her, then it looked like I was worried about her comments.
No, it's just a conflict of interest in associates voting on.
We all have children in the school system, and we voted on the school staff.
Good point.
Any other comments? Do I hear a motion, Mr. Edsel?
I have a motion for the board to consider. Be it ordered that, based on the information presented, the planning board recommends the attached associate member status amendment to the zoning ordinance.
Second.
I have some discussion, and that is just to insert the number 7 in the second line of Boards and Commissions Ordinance. 7, paren, 7 members, just to make it consistent with how you do all the other numbers.
And I would amend my motion, if possible. Are we voting on this? The last page? The text change that I mentioned there. Strike the last 5 words, add to the same board or committee, if that's acceptable.
Are we doing this in 2 stages or one?
Is that a votable issue?
The motion you made is just on the zoning ordinance amendments.
That's 1946?
That's just 1946.
Okay.
It'd be better if you commented on everything. I guess I would be a little bit more comfortable if you dealt with the formal request under the zoning mm-hmm. ordinance separately mm-hmm. from your recommendation on the other things.
Mm-hmm. So be it.
Okay. Motion's been seconded. All those in favor?
So is it, their motion is... is there any motion on the floor now?
Yes.
Yes.
It's your motion on 1946.
Zoning only. Zoning board only. Any further discussion on the motion? All those in favor, please indicate by raising your right hand. Passes unanimously. Now
in, is that where we get salaried? Again.
What's that?
Nothing. I'm still trying to get salaried.
Well, that's the next discussion. Yeah, that's the zoning issue. Now we have the opportunity to send a recommendation to the council regarding the planning board. And those two issues are regarding the number of regular members and the number of terms from 2 to 3. Okay. People understand the reason it was 2 terms was they were once 5-year terms, and now that it's still, now it's been reduced to 3-year terms. Even 3 consecutive 3-year terms would not be as much time as the 2 5-year terms. So that's why we're seeking additional terms. Do I hear a motion on, or is there any discussion on these, on this issue?
Should we try to do this, the 4.2-2 paragraph separate from the end, or you want to do them all together? Okay.
Put them all together. What would do? Put that in a letter form to the council?
Yeah, I could draft a memo. Yeah.
Okay. Ms. McKay, you'll continue to vote on this item?
Yeah, I move that the suggested language with respect to changing the composition of the planning board in section 4-2-2 with the addition of the paren 7 and paren in the second line after the written 7 be recommended, and in addition the proposal relating to term limits for planning board members in section 4 as revised to read in the second sentence, reappointment to that same board or commission may then occur only after a 1-year period of non-service on that board or commission period.
I have a motion. I have a second.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor, raise your right hand. Passes unanimously. Thank you. No effect on the conservation.
No pay again this year.
Okay. Well, thank you.
I like your attitude, Steve.
Any other discussion?
Name and glory.
Do I have a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
All those in favor? We're adjourned. The clock stopped.
Stop.